Yo, this is Teo, back with more House and Fata Morgana. To sort of briefly recap where we were when I left off, we had Bestia, and he was killing a bunch of people, and I was like, no, Bestia, don't do that, don't kill those people. And then Bestia kept killing the people, and I was like, okay, well, fuck you. Yeah, I am not necessarily rooting for you anymore. And then another Bestia showed up, and original Bestia killed that one too, and I was like, yeah, that one's probably more defensible. And that's where we are. And we, I guess, are about to see how white-haired girl interacts or reacts to Bestia's stabbing habits. Also, don't know if I'm gonna be able to finish this part tonight, like 50-50. I guess you guys could skip to the end of the video and find out, or you could follow along with me and find out as I do. There are all sorts of exciting options available to you, but me, being constrained by the flow of time, have only one direction to go, and that's forward. So, have at it. Me. You come back again, okay? Promise me. I'll be waiting. Waiting, believing that you'll return. I'll be waiting. Might not be keeping that promise. Definitely got stabbed. It's about time for you to set off. Indeed. You take care out there. Don't eat anything funny and get yourself sick, got it? I'll be fine. I'm a tough one. The more overconfident you are, the more you'll push yourself and risk getting hurt. Make sure you drink lots and lots of water, okay? Ah, advice that I'm planning to live by. Take care not to get heatstroke or sunstroke, okay? You worry too much. Relax, I know how to take care of myself on a ship. Also, this background music is super loud, I'm gonna, like, tank my volume again. I know, but you never know what might happen. I want you to be in good health when I see you again. I will be. But I'll probably keep you waiting for a long time again. I'll be waiting. Don't worry about me. I'll be waiting, I promise. I managed to wait a year and a half already, so I can handle this. Come back, okay? You have my word. Lies. Thanks. Safe travels. I refuse to believe that he could be dead. I have to find proof that somewhere out there, he's still alive and well. I have to find him. I have to prove it. Okay, so this is actually something that I was thinking of over sort of the past couple days that sort of annoyed me about House and Fata Morgana, is there just aren't enough set pieces to have a satisfying mystery. Like, in any given door so far, and obviously I still have most of the game in front of me, so I'm fully prepared for this to change, and even if it doesn't, it's not like that's gonna ruin the story. It just feels like there aren't enough things being presented to me to make even the individual mysteries, or like, mystery of how it's gonna play out within each door, feel necessarily surprising. Like, there's so few characters being shown that there's, like, only so many things you can do with those characters. And then once one character is given a little bit of screen time, they either, like, they basically have to come back and be relevant again, just because the game is given itself so, like, few pieces to work with. It's like kind of like the endgame tables in chess, where if there's only six pieces on the board, like, a computer has brute force solved the problem already. And it's like how the first time Pauline's sprite showed up in this door, like, obviously she's going to show up again because they wouldn't waste a sprite on a two-line scene. And I think that's ultimately sort of making the core mysteries of the story, like the ones around the house and the protagonist and the maid, a little bit less interesting, just because if there was more pieces that the game was giving me to play with, it could give me more hints, but it has so few pieces, it just has to, like, drip feed me information without, because if it gives me, like, any information, it's too obvious, because there's not enough, there isn't, like, just a density of information to sort of obscure the truth with. And I think that's a style of storytelling that I find more interesting, but again, it's not like I'm writing off the story or anything. That's just one sort of small complaint I had with the way the story is presenting itself, is that each door doesn't feel like it has enough. Like, it doesn't, the content in each door isn't wide enough to properly obscure hints, so they can't really give me strong hints. That's what it feels like, at least. Because I feel like I haven't been given enough hints to make, like, large inferences about the main mystery. And first of all, it's like not even halfway into the second door, so they probably shouldn't be giving me too blatant of hints yet. And also, they might be giving me blatant hints and I just haven't gotten them, if, like, I haven't picked up on them, in which case, like, props to the author, because I feel like I'm still in the dark, like, more or less completely, as to the overarching story, and maybe it just hasn't kicked in yet, or maybe I've, like, missed all the hints, but that's sort of my diatribe for the moment. So that's something I'll be, like, actively looking for, like, stuff to start tying together, sort of in more interesting ways. But anyways, back to the story. We have arrived at our destination, madam. Though I dearly wish I could assist you in your search, I have things to attend to during our stay. No, don't worry yourself. I couldn't possibly impose on you any further. Madam Pauline, you mustn't put yourself in danger. Should anything happen to you, your mother would be devastated. I wonder if Mom's mad. No, she's probably sad. Her sorrow as expansive as the Albufera wetlands, as deep as the ocean into which the sun sets. And it's all my fault. But don't worry, I'll be fine. As soon as I have certainty of his well-being, I'll go straight home. Me and him, together. Pauline, your lover is... I have faith in him. He would never break a promise to me. Yet, funny how swords have a way of, like, stopping people from, like, going back to the place they came from. It's always come back to me, no matter how long it took. A man like that wouldn't just suddenly disappear on me. There's been a mistake, and I have to prove it. Oh dear. This isn't ending well. There's, like, no way this ends well. I have to be the one to do it, because he'll remain gone unless I see it with my own eyes. I wonder who you inherited your stubbornness from. What? Nothing. An acquaintance of mine lives in this village. I shall be staying with him. I'll let him know about you. He shall gladly welcome you into his home. Thank you, Orlando. You've been such a big help. Wait, we have his name now. Why is it still other? Why isn't it Orlando? Pauline. Hmm? 1 month. You search for 1 month, and if you haven't found him, you come home with me. Will you promise me that? You are her only daughter. Okay. Good. To tell you the truth, I regret bringing you with me. What I should have done is dragged you back home. But I couldn't bear to see you like that, Pauline. It was like I was looking at her when she was younger. Orlando. Anyway, 1 month. Understood? Yes. Don't worry, a month will be plenty. I will find him before the month is up. The sleepy seaside village is on the small side, but from what I've been told, it used to have a flourishing fishing industry. Now, though, it's like there's a fog hanging over everything. That's not too surprising, I suppose. A few months ago, the village was part of a war for control of the country, and they're now under a different rule than before. Stripped of their independence and battered by the raging tempest of war, people's spirits have been eroded, and spiritual damage is not so easily mended. Even if they were not physically harmed, there are deep wounds in their hearts. It's a lovely village, though. The breeze feels different than it does back home. Beneath it all, I'm sure the people are actually quite friendly and cheerful. A long, long time ago, I went on a trip to a land in the south. This country is quite a bit south of mine, too. People blessed with lots of sunlight are bound to be warm at their core. Say, Orlando. Wait, I live in Seattle. What does that say about me? Yes? May I take a look around the village? I don't see why not. Sun's still up. I'll need some time to catch up with my acquaintance, so I suppose this is as good a time as any, as good an opportunity as any. Do you know where to find me, madam? Yes, you go down that way, turn at the second crossroad, follow it straight for a little, cross over to the other side, and it's right there, right? Are you sure you can find it? Don't worry. Alright then. You're planning to stay within the village today, right? I'll see you in a little bit then. If you get lost, give me a holler. As much as you may insist otherwise, you really do care, Orlando. Feel bad enough as it is. Please don't take advantage of me. I think I might take full advantage of this. Thanks! See you in a bit! Don't know what to make of Pauline yet. She hasn't really done anything to make me like or dislike her particularly strongly. Hmm? What's she doing out here all alone, I wonder? There's no one else around. I wonder if something happened. Would it seem odd if I tried talking to him? Wouldn't want to get labeled as suspicious on my first day here. That's asking for trouble, but the boy stands all alone on the shore, looking somehow precarious. As though a breeze might whisk him away into a million grains of sand, and if I look away, he won't be there when I turn back. He has the like flaxen hair thing going on. Maybe he's important to the overarching story. I wouldn't put money on it, though. He has a sprite! I don't know. I was like just saying that like all the characters with sprites end up being important, so maybe this guy is related to the Rose Manor group. That's how the boy appears to me. You never know until you try. Besides, it's important for me to communicate with the natives. Got to build trust with the people of this village. Let's go. Good afternoon. What are you doing out here all alone, little man? By force of habit, I spoke in my native tongue. How dense can you be, Pauline? You may have just been talking to Orlando, but that's no excuse. This isn't your homeland. But everything's all right. I study the language, so I should be able to hold a simple conversation. You don't need to be afraid of me. My name is Pauline. I'll be staying in your village for a while. Nice to meet you. Do you not understand me? My name is Pauline. What is your name, little man? Dreadful. What? He just called me dreadful. It's one hell of an accent you've got. Who are you, a bandit? What are you here for? No, not a damn bit, I promise. I stammered. Atrocious. There's no need to be so mean. I put in a pretty good effort, I thought. You could at least compliment me instead. God-awful. I like this guy. That's not nice. What's a foreigner doing here in this remote corner of the world? Sightseeing our little village? Sure got a lot of time on your hands. I do not. I'm very busy. You're a little obnoxious, aren't you? You're supposed to treat your elders with respect, you know? Like I give a damn, lady. You're older, but you're acting way more like a kid than me. My name isn't Lady, it's Pauline. Pauline. And? What are you here for? Completely ignored. Ahem. I am, here to look for someone. There are rumors that he was last seen around here. Have you, by any chance, seen any other foreigners around? Hell if I know. He just won't let me in. Gotta befriend him first. Of course he's going to be guarded if I just start throwing questions at him. Alright, so you haven't seen him. Then why don't you tell me about yourself? What are you doing out here? Is that any of your business, lady? Boys out here on a beach all alone, wouldn't that make you curious? Don't you have any friends? Wow, you're really not good at this making friends thing. Maybe he's one of those kids who doesn't have any. Say, if you don't mind, could we be friends? I'm not really familiar with the area, so it'd be nice to have someone with me. What do you say? I don't need any damn friends. Alright, Javi's my hero. And who the hell would be dumb enough to say, sure, I'll be your friend to someone they just met? How are you so jaded? You need to be more courteous, kinder to others, not so antagonistic. No, Javi, you be you. Don't let anyone talk you out of it. I just thought it would be nice if we could talk a bit. That's all I want, really. How about you quit being so damn nosy, lady? Just so happens I like being alone. Alright, can Javi be the protagonist now? Let's get rid of this Pauline lady. I've got some strange woman ruining my alone time. I'm out of here. Hey, wait a second! No, come back, protagonist! I love you! I just met you, and now I love you! Ah, he's gone. This is going to be really, really hard! I mean, in fairness, probably not everyone you interact with is going to be as antisocial as Javi was. Like, Master? Ah, you've returned to me. You suddenly started staring off into the distance. I was quite startled. Now, let us continue our tale. The mansion's corridor was a horrifically repulsive mess. Splatters of fresh beast blood covered the walls, and there was a repugnant odor. Anyone would be compelled to avert their eyes at the sight. What happened here? I am grateful that you cannot see, because you would certainly think me a beast if you were able to see this. Because you cannot see, you do not know what I look like. But I know. Another beast, like me, broke into the mansion. Was it? I protected you! Did I not? I protected you! Say that I protected you! That I did this for you! In his hysteria, Bestia tore down the curtains hanging on the hallway window. Bloodstained curtains that reeked of dead beast. What did he have to be so afraid of, though? He had exterminated the other beast encroaching upon his territory. I would understand if he had puffed his chest in pride, but far from that, his terror merely intensified. Come down. The white-haired girl extended her beast for Bestia, but even her gentle, lovingly outstretched fingers evoked fear in his eyes. Instinctively, he feared anything that entered his territory, and then attempted to remove it. And driven by those instincts, he shoved aside the white-haired girl, the one he said he had wanted to protect. Ah! Being without sight, she had no way of reliably catching her balance, and she fell to the floor with a splash, for she had landed in the pool of blood left by the beast. Red seeped into her clothing, slowly spreading through the fabric. At first, it looked like she had fallen into a puddle of fresh, bright dye, but before long, the red darkened into a brownish-black.
I'm sorry, I didn't... No, I...
It's okay, I'm fine. She embraced the panicking beast, softly whispering, shh, shh, as if trying to calm a crying baby. The bestia was taller and physically stronger. The white-haired girl was, emotionally, more stable than he. What has you so frightened? Please, tell me. I promise I will not look down on you, for any reason. All I want is to free you from the depths of your suffering. Sometimes talking about things can lighten the burden they place on you. We have the ability to use words, both you and me. With language, the gift God bestowed upon man, we can communicate our feelings with one another. It's all right. Don't be afraid. Talk to me, please. Am I a man? You act as though I am a man. No, you treat me like one. I cannot see you as anything else, as I have said before.
Only because you cannot see me! You are the only one who says I am a man. You, who are without sight.
But I was content with that. You treated me like a man, so I felt as though I'd become one. The time I spent with you, I had real peace. I almost forgot that I was a wretched beast. I no longer sought after prey. Prey, oh yes. Before you arrived, I murdered dozens of humans. I didn't want you to know that I was such a sinful creature, leaving a long trail of bodies in my wake. But I thought that if I didn't show them my strength, if I didn't force them into submission, that I would never find peace. I was drunk with power. I took great pleasure in it, in slaughtering people. The fear was so overwhelming that you turned the act of killing into one of gratification. You did it to protect yourself. Are you still not going to condemn me? Taking another's life is wrong. Not only does it rob them of their time on this earth, it inflicts great wounds upon those who care about them. However, I do not regard you as a mere beast, nor as a mere murderer. Something made you the way you are. I'm almost certain of it. Something. Tell me about yourself. In your words, from your mouth, tell me. My money's on the mansion. This mansion is messed up. When I woke up, I was weak, exhausted, emaciated. I couldn't think clearly, or even remember much of anything. I was thirsty, hungry, sore from head to toe. A crowd of people surrounded me. You. This was a long time ago. Well, not so long as to be described as long ago, but it is as far back as my past goes. I sought help from the people around me, but my words did not get through to them. The only thing that came from my mouth were feral howls. They scowled at me, and then... Stinking gross. No interest in any more trouble. Shall we kill it? Never seen anyone like this before. What is he, anyway? Beats me. Bestia, by the looks of it. Bestia. 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 I didn't understand what they were saying about me. All I could pick out was the word bestia. The humans brought sticks and fishing poles, with which they poked and prodded me. At first, they probably meant only to chase me out. But before long, their actions began to escalate. Bestia. Bestia. Filthy beast. We ain't got nothing for you. Dirty, nasty thing. Stay back. Hit it. Pound it. He's feeling it. Beat it. Beat the thing. Kill it. Kill it. Kill it. Kill it. Kill it. Die. Why? Why should I have to die? I was simply asking for help. If they didn't have food to spare, a glass of water would have been enough. I asked for nothing of them but some relief from my thirst. But the humans would not hear my pleas. My words reached no one's ears. When they brought weapons and started chasing me around, attempting to kill me, then all I could do anymore was run. As I fled, I saw something. A child, pointing to a wild dog covered in mud and shouting, Bestia! That was when I finally understood that I was a beast. And that was why the humans wanted to exterminate me. I was neither cattle, nor swine, nor fowl of the air, but a vicious beast, the kind of creature that ravaged their fields. And so, you sought to prove your superiority to them, or you would never have to be called a beast or chased out of somewhere again.
I was so close to forgetting it all. The time I spent with you was truly wonderful. I could forget about people calling me a beast, chasing me around and trying to kill me. I could forget about slaughtering them, painting the walls with their blood. I could forget about everything. It felt like I'd actually become a man. But you... Then it showed up. Another beast, like me, was my kin. A different individual, though, built differently than me. I am taller than it was, but it was a beast. And I, too, must be a beast. Regardless, I will continue to insist you are not, as many times as I must. Should you be troubled by these painful memories and attempt to cause someone harm again, I will be there to remind you of your humanity. Is that which you can see with your eyes, the whole of the world? I cannot see you, that is correct. But I can feel you, sense you, hear you, and I can learn what you bear within your heart. You worry, you fear, and you think. And you also show concern for me. These things all prove that you are human. This woman, she really is going to change me. If I remain with her, I can become a man. It might be no more than an illusion, but with her near, it can become my reality. Have you calmed yourself down some? The hall needs to be cleaned. So it does. I'll take care of it. You don't need to worry. You should get changed, though. Very well. I believe I care so much for you. Because you resemble me. But you're not alike in the slightest. As I've said, you're a beautiful woman. You may compliment my appearance, but no one else ever did. I've been labeled a witch because of the colors of my eyes and hair. No, that's not true. Mel totally complimented your appearance. Man, now I'm sad. My eyes, they're red. A beautiful shade of red indeed. Magnificent color, like blood. You're the first person to say that about them. Even my mother said my eyes frightened her. Because people called me a witch, I was rarely afforded the opportunity to interact with others, so I grew up mostly alone. As the people outside the mansion called you a beast, so too the people outside call me a witch. See? We are alike. Do I look like a witch to you? No, you are a beautiful, compassionate human woman. And you are a human man, even if you don't believe it yourself. Yet again, Bestia found himself feeling grateful for the white-haired girl's blindness. For, while he had just managed to put on a smile, tears were also rolling down his cheeks. Joy, bitterness, sorrow, a maelstrom of emotions flowed unbounded from within. But he cried in silence. Bestia shed his tears discreetly so as to not allow the white-haired girl to notice. He looked down upon the floor. A single corpse lay there. And no matter how hard he tried, he could not see it as anything other than a beast. A beast that looked just like him. He came from a faraway land, across many seas. There was never any guarantee that we would see each other again. But I still believe that no matter how great the ocean that divided us, that we were bound by our love. The only thing that needed to stand between us was physical distance. I wonder if he's here yet. Hello, my little Nijnit? That is not an English word. I would bet money on it. What has you so out of breath? Eek! Oh, don't scare me like that. And where did you pick up a word like Nijnit? I never took you for someone so pretentious. I'm sorry. You just looked so much like a rabbit there, the way you were tossing your head back and forth, looking around for me. Oh, you. Nijit is something you call a child. Not a little girl anymore. I'm sorry, really. Don't be so mad, Pauline. If I have to pretend to pronounce that word one more time, I'm gonna snap. And by snap, I mean, like, laugh internally at myself. Same difference. I'm not mad at all. It's been a year and a half. We finally get to see each other again. That we do. Did you have any troubles out at sea? Did you fall ill or get caught in a storm or run into any danger at all? No, there was no trouble. Everything went fine, without incident. Sea God was watching over us, I suppose. Thank goodness. I was so worried. But you kept your promise. You came back for me. And you kept yours and waited for me. Of course I did. I trust you, and I don't mind waiting. Even so, 18 months must have been a long time for you. It was. Felt long to me as well. Every day I would picture your face, recall the sound of your voice. But over time, I began to lose surety. It absolutely terrified me. Is that what you actually looked like? Is this truly the sound of your voice? You mean you almost forgot? Not at all, Pauline. I was afraid that,
In my profound love for you, my mind had created its own image. That perhaps my adoration had grown so strong that it turned you into a transcendent beauty like Cleopatra herself. You must have made some unseemly friends. You were never this much of a sweet talker. Bet you're disappointed, though. Look at me, a homely woman you could find anywhere. Haha, for some reason I find myself in a teasing mood. Please have mercy, or I'm liable to lose your affection. What I'm trying to say is that being here with the real you, putting my hands in yours, listening to you speak, and seeing you be, well, you, Pauline, is so much more wondrous than anything I imagined. And right now, I'm feeling that stronger than ever. You seem to have found yourself a way with words. Imagine you have plenty of time to practice on other women. Goodness, you fiend. Fiend? It's not terribly convincing with your cheeks the color of wine. They are not! God. Hey now, don't throw a fit. Ah, they're cute. You're the only one who can put me in such high spirits with a few simple words. Huh? Did you say something? Who, me? No, not a thing. Say, you're finally back. How about we take a walk around town? You've taken care of all your work for the time being, right? So can you spare some time for me? Absolutely, Pauline. As much as time allows, I will spend it with you. As much as time allows. They're cute. I'd be more excited about their romance if I didn't already know that the guy was dead. There's still no trace of him. It's been a week, and I found nothing. Considering my time limit, that needs to change fast. But... excuse me, have you seen this man? This is a drawing of what he looks like. Sorry, never seen him. Even the smallest piece of information helps. If you've heard of anyone who might have seen him... Said I haven't seen him, so I don't know what to tell you. I'm a busy woman. Would you mind moving aside? Sorry. I was told that that my lover lost his life out on work. But I don't believe it. They haven't shown me a body, so their information has to be an error. I have to be the one to find him, to prove he's still alive. I have to follow his tracks. I've heard word that remnants of his ship drifted ashore near this village. So if he survived, he must be somewhere nearby. I'm certain of it, but I haven't been able to find any information of the sort. The villagers aren't being very cooperative. They're all just as reserved as the day I arrived. Rather, I get the feeling that they want to stay as far away from trouble as they can. No matter what I ask, I can't get a straight answer from anyone. Yeah, if there was a mansion that, like, people kept disappearing into, I would be a little bit apprehensive about, like, talking about it as well. Like, especially if this is, what, early 1700s? Like, I'm not a historian or anything, but I feel like attitudes on magic and the reality thereof are probably a little bit looser in the 1700s than they are in present day. So you're like, yeah, so that mansion might actually just be magic and killing people, so I should probably not talk about it. This seems like a reasonable attitude to hold. Everyone's still closed off because of the war, I guess. That's also reasonable, but pretty sure it's because, like, people keep disappearing into the mansion, and, like, it's real sketch. I don't have time for people to be glum, though. Ah, it's that boy. He's at the shore again. Always alone. God have mercy, you again? Man, I love Javi. He's my new favorite. What are you doing here? And always so callous. Came to get sentimental and watch the sunset. So original. What does it matter if I visit the seashore? The ocean doesn't belong to anyone. If I'm such a bother, then you're free to leave like last time. You sure are cheeky for an outsider. I know that the rest of the village isn't being all that cooperative. Nope. And that's what this place is like now. Closed off. It's not kind to outsiders. You really going to be able to keep up the search with the entire town stonewalling you? Yes, I will. Won't give up, for any reason. I have to find him, to bring him home with me. Lady, you're... My name isn't Lady, it's Pauline. Pauline. Lady is... Pauline. Pauline is the person you're looking for still alive? That is an interesting question. He is. He has to be. Is that so? Well, have fun with that. Doubt you're gonna get any help, though. Ah, he really left. Don't lose heart, Pauline. If you lose faith this easily, you'll never find him. He is alive, isn't he? He is alive. I have faith. I believe. Hey, he's back. Oh, I thought you had left. Take it. You're ruining the scenery pacing around on the beach. Is this an orange? They grow pretty large here, huh? Yeah, the oranges around these parts are pretty good. People used to come out here just to buy them, in fact. You went to get one just for me. Just want to get rid of you. Oh my god. Javi's Hudson did it. What an adorable young man. Once you finish that, get lost, alright? Thanks, I appreciate it. You're not so bad after all. Like I said, this isn't me being nice or anything. It's not like I wanted to give you an orange or anything, baka. Oh, there you go again. Yeah, I've got you all figured out, little man. You're actually a very sweet boy. And you were really trying to cheer me up, weren't you? Javi. What? My name. Not little man, it's Javi. Alright then, Javier it is. No, not Javier, just Javi. Don't see what the big deal is, but okay. Come on now! You spent the last however long you've been interacting with this guy, like, insisting that he call you Pauline, and now you're gonna get snippy when, like, he tells you his name? I feel like you, of all people, should be, like, receptive to calling people by the name that they want to be called. Say, Javi, I really think we should be friends. What? Come on, let's be friends. Don't say you don't need any. You can make me friend number one. We'll have lots of fun. Just want me to use me in your search, because you can't get the villagers to talk on your own. No, I mean it, really. No, come on, let's be honest, Pauline. You're wasting your time. I'm just as much trouble for them as you. Using me isn't going to get you anywhere. Trouble? What do you mean by that, Javi? Nothing you need to know, lady. Bye, and stay away from the shore. Hold on a second. What? Pauline. What? My name isn't Lady, it's Pauline. Listen to me, Javi. I have no intention whatsoever of using you. I enjoy talking to you, and I think it'd be fun if I could do it more. That's why I want to be friends. I can find you here at the beach, right? I'll be back, Javi. You won't change my mind. I will make you my friend, Javi. What the hell, lady? Did you hear a word I said? I don't need any damn friends. Stay away from the beach. Nope, you will be my friend. And this is where we get a restraining order. Ain't happening. Wait, Javi! No, run, Javi. Run as fast as you can. See you again. I'm not kidding, I will come back. You might need to, like, not go to the beach for a while, Javi. It's okay, she has to leave at the end of the month. We can wait her out. We can just camp until the game ends. I'd actually at first been thinking that it would be easier to get information if I could make friends with someone in the village. But the orange Javi gave me when I was sad and lonely and hurting was so amazingly fresh and delicious, more than any orange I've ever had before. It was almost as though Javi's kindness was seeping directly into my mouth. I'm sure we'll be able to get along. I want to be his friend. Time is the only thing moving forward in my search. Some days, I would ask my mom's friend, Orlando, to accompany me on trips outside the village, but no matter where I go, I just hear the same thing. The views of the ocean always keep me from getting too dejected. It's an unimaginably huge chasm that keeps us apart, but at the same time, there's something beautiful about the way that sea encompasses the entire world. The emerald expanse. It simultaneously robs me of him and soothes my heart with its stunning brilliance. Perhaps I feel such awe and admiration for it, because I was born along the seaside. Oh, bar down the beach. He's not here today? Javi, are you there? That's odd. Can always find him here. Hey, Javi, where'd you go? Is he dead? I can't believe you fell for that. Okay. Javi, there's only so lovable you can be. You're, like, already pushing the cap. You don't need to push anymore. A pitfall? That's not very nice, Javi. Oh my god, it's a pitfall trap? Based on the sound effect, I'd assume he was, like, hiding in the bushes or something. It's even better. Why can't Javi be the protagonist? I just want 15 hours of Javi's antics. Why would you do that to me? Because you won't stop following me around. Do you have any idea how annoying that is? And see, Javi, this is why we don't feed the crazy people. Because if we feed them, they'll keep coming back. Doesn't mean you have to do something so cruel. Maybe now you'll learn your lesson and stay away from the beach. Jerk. Hey. Wait, you seriously crying? Hey, don't cry. Just kidding. I'm not crying. Well, come on, you were faking? You tricked me? You played the first mean prank, Javi. Yeah, you don't get to complain, Javi. Well, you should have seen through it, but you don't get to complain. You really scared me there. I kept telling you to stay away. It's your fault for constantly refusing to listen. I'm surprised you haven't gotten bored yet. You must have a lot of time on your hands. I most certainly do not have a lot of time. My deadline for how long I can be here is quickly approaching. But I'll just get depressed if I spend all that time searching. If I can have some fun with you, Javi, then I'll have more energy. Fun, huh? So you still haven't found him?
No.
You don't even know if the guy's alive or dead. Just forget it. I'm out of here. Ah, hold on a second. Ow! Ow! Come on, you're not gonna fool me again. No, I'm not joking around. I really... Looks like I twisted my ankle. Haha, but I'll be just fine. Don't worry about me. Wait there. Huh? I was gonna make a splint or something. Come on, let me see your foot. Alright. Ankle swollen. At least it'll learn to land properly. What? You're gonna blame me when you're the one who dug the hole? No one's ever gotten hurt in the trap that basic. At least none of my friends ever did. Weren't you the one who just said you don't have friends? What, I thought you didn't have friends, Javi. Oh, shut your damn mouth. I'm gonna bandage your ankle. Ah, I see. You went to get a bandage for me. Thank you. It was my fault, anyway. Swap it out for a real bandage when you can. I'm sure your acquaintance has some. Really? Looks just fine to me. This filthy thing isn't suitable for someone like you, lady. Pauline, quit that. What do you mean, not suitable? Do I have to explain everything? You're from a pretty well-off country, aren't you, Pauline? Well, compared to that, this is a poor village. We don't even have clean bandages to spare. Just gross scraps of cloth like this. It's not something you should be wearing. You think so? But you gave it to me, Javi. I won't be changing it anytime soon. That's how you get infections, Pauline. Tell me, Javi, do you not like this village? The only thing this place has going for it is the ocean. And the oranges. The ocean. It's the one thing that doesn't change no matter what. It's always beautiful. I see. You like the ocean too, Javi. I just don't have anything else to like. What about the oranges? Oh, there you go again. Oh, I've got an idea. Javi. What now? Rowboat. I want to take a ride in a rowboat. Would anyone get mad if we borrowed the one tied up over there for just a little bit? Doubt anyone would care if it's just for a little. Can you row, though, lady? You'll do the rowing, Javi. Oh, come on. Huh? Why me? It's a big deal. The water's mostly calm today. I think a little walk on the sea would be lovely. Can you call that a walk? Sure you can. Come on, let's go. Give me a hand, Javi. God, you are one cheeky outsider. The breeze feels different on the water than it does on the beach, wouldn't you say? Think so? All the same to me. No, it's definitely different. The smell of salt is stronger, and there's more moisture in the air. It's kind of like someone gently caressing your cheek. Not getting any of that. You're way too perceptive, lady. Am I? Close your eyes, Javi. Feel the breeze. I bet you'll get what I'm saying. Go on, close your eyes. No. I'm not going to. What? Why not? I just don't want to do what you tell me. Oh, no need to be petty. See, it's not always so kind. The hand that's gently caressing your cheek can, in the blink of an eye, become the wrinkled hand of a witch that destroys everything it touches. The ocean is a scary thing. It's nothing we humans have any chance of standing up against. You're right. And I know it very, very well. The man I'm searching for was in a shipwreck. I was told it killed him, but I refused to believe that he would just leave me behind like that. Sometimes, on a whim, the wrinkly witch might have mercy. I'm not so sure about that. I trust in the sea's gentleness. I don't think it's all scary. Soft breeze, these calm waves. They saved him, I'm sure of it. He loved the ocean too, you know. He was always looking into the distance out across the water. His head held high, a stern, unwavering look in his eyes. I'm assuming he's your lover? Yes. He's very dear to me, and I love him deeply. Oh, I see. He was really fond of the sea by my hometown. You live in a decent town, huh? Yep, it's wonderful. It's so peaceful, and everyone's so nice. There's not a single bad person living there. Oh, I know, Javi. You should come visit my hometown sometime. Visit your home? Yeah, the ocean there is really pretty, too. The colors are a little deeper than what they are here. It's like so many jewels sparkling in the light. I'm sure you'll love it, Javi. I'd love for you to come and visit. We can go see all sorts of things. There's a shop that sells great ham sandwiches. I don't have money for a trip. Maybe not now, but you could in the future. Or, if you're interested at all, we could ask Orlando to bring you back with us, Javi. If you don't want to stay here, that is. Along with the guy you're looking for? Yep, I'm sure he'd be happy to have you along. Give it some thought. You'd enjoy it, I'm sure. You sound like a child. Hmm? Nothing. I doubt I could even get permission to leave. Permission? Oh, right. Are your parents pretty strict, Javi? No. They're both dead. Both my mom and my dad. What? They were murdered. So I'm staying with an acquaintance. They try to work me like a horse, though, so I sneak out here when I get the chance. Was it in the war? The war? What are you talking about, lady? Huh? Wasn't this country involved in a war not too long ago?
There was a war, yes, but no soldiers ever reached this village.
Then why would they be killed?
Is the beast. The beast? Yeah, the beast. He showed up one day and destroyed everything. The peace, my family, my friends. Now, it's interesting. Are they talking about our Bestia or the one that Bestia killed? Because it's like 50-50, right? It's like probably the first Bestia, but it could very well be the second one, so let's not jump to conclusions. Merchants and travelers visiting the village. Everyone and everything. He slaughtered everything and then he disappeared. That man, at best he destroyed everything. He's a murderous beast. The whole village is terrified of him. Although I guess if, like, the original Bestia was the one responsible for murdering a bunch of people in the village, like, that doesn't change his sort of moral standing in the bigger picture. Like, he's already killed a bunch of people. What's another couple people on top of that, right? It's like, doesn't really tip the scales that much farther. He's a murderous beast. The whole village is terrified of him. They go through their days like lifeless dolls, enveloped in a storm cloud of terror. Bestia, a murderous beast. So the grim air hanging in the village isn't because of the war? It's because a beast has been killing people? A beast? Why would... But... Hey, Javi. You said there were merchants and travelers visiting the village. Can you describe them for me? They're all sorts. Like the one who stopped by on the road to somewhere else. An international traveler on an international trader on his way to purchase goods. Well, we have a lead. Alright, quick water break while the scene's changing. I see Bestia is also in the mood for water. 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 I just need some water. Just some water. Story of my life, dude. Will they attack me again? No, if I ask. Did they look like they were open to requests? No, they tried to kill me. They almost killed me. They threw stones at me. They did more than that. Hoes and knives and sticks and I don't know, things I don't even recognize. They hit me with them. They tried to kill me. They looked like they were gonna kill me. I almost died. I'm on the verge of death even now. My throat is sore. It hurts. No, I don't feel pain anymore. It burns? Does it burn? I don't know. 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 I don't know anything. I'm so thirsty. Water. I just need water. Will they not even give me any water? Why? Why not? Because I'm a Bestia? Because I'm a beast. Because I don't need to live. Because I don't deserve to live. Are beasts meant to die? Am I meant to die? I'm thirsty. My stomach is probably empty, too. Don't know anymore, but I'm hungry. So very hungry. I can't take it, 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 I can't take it. Water. I just need some water. Just some water. What must I do to get some water from that village? A well. A well. I can find a well. There has to be a well. I know what that is. I know what a well is. What else do I know? Nothing. Nothing, nothing. I have no memories. I have nothing. I'm a beast. A newborn beast. I would not at all be surprised if Bestia's origins are, like, relevant in the broader sense. Like, maybe he just came from nothing. Maybe he... I don't know. Maybe he's connected to the mansion. I would certainly not write that possibility off. Give, like, 30%. And it was, like, 70%, like, his backstory isn't relevant. What's this? It's buried. It's red. It feels rough. Ha. 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 There's something. There's something. Something I know. I know this. This is mine. It must be. It's mine. I know this. It's mine. I know how to use it, how to touch it, how to hold it, how to swing it. Oh, this is the like, sword that never stops being shiny, I think. Right? The one that he carries around. I know this. I know what this is, what to do with it, what it's for. I know that with this, I can fight on equal footing with them. A beast. 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 I'm a beast. Beasts are meant to be ridiculed, to be hated, to be resented, to die. But I want to live, which means I only have one option. Only one way. Only one. With this, I must overthrow those who tormented me. I can do that. Water and food. I can get that. I can get anything. Ha 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 ha. Who could that be at this time of night? Who's there? You shouldn't answer it. It's probably a beggar or something. These are dangerous times. You're right. How unpleasant a world we live in, that we should have to fear for our lives in this little village. Unpleasant indeed. I hope things go back to how they used to be soon enough.
Gah, you just don't give up. Who's there? You're not coming in without identifying yourself.
This is rather strange. What's going on, Dad? Oh, did the noise wake you? It's nothing to worry about, son. Go back to bed. It'll be quiet. It'll quiet down soon. The door, huh?
Rah.
Ah! Ah! Gah!
What's?
And then Bestia murdered some more people.
Mom? Ah! 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 Javi! Look away! Why is the Bestia...
Rah, rah, rah.
Run, you hear me?
Go out the back door and let everyone know. Shout as loud as you... Ah!
What is this? What's going on? Why? There's blood! Why? It can't be! What the... How did this... Why? Why? Mom! Dad!
Rah.
Bestia!
Bestia! The Bestia! You... Why would you...
Rah.
Ah! Ah!
Also, I can't remember if I mentioned this or not, but, like, I'm still super suspicious of the fact that they, like, have his form concealed. Like, it's entirely possible that, like, his actual appearance is a twist of some variety.
Ha. Ha. Ha.
Mm. Ha. What's the matter? You sound like you're in pain. Would you like me to fetch you some water?
Water?
Don't touch me. Keep your hands off me.
Not a particularly restful sleep, I take it.
You... Where are you hiding? Why did you disappear? You were always around before.
Show yourself. Show yourself immediately. Where are you? Show yourself. And if I did, what would you do then? Kill me? You thirst for blood, to instill fear, to live? In the face of your desire, others' lives are meaningless. That's the kind of man you are. Or, do you intend to pretend that you never did anything of the sort?
Shut up, shut up, shut up! I couldn't help it. I wanted to live. I didn't want to die.
Yes, yes indeed. That's the kind of man you are. You'll kill for your own sake.
Hehe.
You kill a child's mother and father as he stands there watching.
They tried to kill me first. All of them. The entire village.
Calm yourself. Who are you speaking to? Please, get a hold of yourself.
Silence. Stop talking. Keep your hands off me. I'll kill you too. I'm a beast. We'll kill anyone.
Calm down. It's all right. Everything's all right. It's all right.
I'm a beast. Beasts kill. And so I kill.
Breathe slower. I will not harm you, and you will not harm me. It's all right. Put your arms around me. See for yourself that I'm not afraid of you.
This is brilliant. What are you clinging onto this woman for?
Is that the only way you can maintain your grip on yourself? It would be so, so much easier if you simply accepted the fact that you're a beast. You've always, always been one, haven't you? Can a beast cultivate love like a human? I'm curious if he's talking to, like, voices in his head or the maid. It's a little bit ambiguous. Like, his initial lines about, like, you always used to be here, etc., etc., like, made me think it was the maid, because the maid, like, went into hiding at some point in the story. But he could also just be talking to, like, the voices in his head. That also seems entirely plausible.
Weep in sorrow like a human? No, they cannot. It's utterly ridiculous.
Shut up.
Shut up, shut up!
It's alright. I'm right here. I'm right here. Because, like, it doesn't make sense for the maid to be, like, goading him into killing people, right? Like, that doesn't really fit her agenda. Her agenda is, like, let's make Bestia into a proper master so that he can be the master of the house because I'm a maid and that's what I want, I guess. Like, I really want the house to have a master so I can hang out with people. But then she, like, went into hiding because she wasn't needed. I'm still not entirely sure what the maid's game is. Like, what's her end game? What's her mid-game, even? Presumably all this will become clear in time. Can I trust you?
Of course.
This little facade will be over soon enough. It will end at that woman's hands, because that's what she's here for. To crush your soul into tiny pieces. Maybe it's the mansion. Maybe the mansion is chatting with him. Because, like, if the mansion is cursed, then it, like, totally makes sense for the mansion to be goading him into killing people. Because I guess that's what it does. I can't remember if there was a scene earlier where he was like, this isn't what I wished for, and the mansion was like, yeah, it totally is, nerd. Why don't you go kill some more people? It'll be hilarious. Because if there was a scene like that, then it makes sense that he's talking, then it, like, sort of confirms that he's talking to the mansion. But if I'm misremembering and that sort of scene never happened, then I'm left with, like, I guess the three original options, which is maid, voices in his head, mansion acting as a voice in his head. Like, I don't know if I'm supposed to have a better sense of that or not. Anyhow, we met 3 years ago. I thought for sure I would get burnt sitting beneath the hellishly pounding sun on the sweltering summer day. It's only ever on days such as those that we end up having lunch outside. Not just out of the house, literally outside. The heat was searing. I could hear the cry of seagulls from the restaurant's terrace. Oh, cry of seagulls, you say? Now you have my attention. I remember the day clear as crystal. Ah, yes, I have to say, the food here is spectacular. Wait. I'm confused. Why is Pauline's father... Oh, this isn't Pauline's father. They're just like... There's like more than two people having lunch right now. Okay. I figured it out eventually. Ah, yes, I have to say, the food here is spectacular. And I love that they give you so much meat. Man. Must be nice. Though I thought in my gut it would explode the first time I thought. Haha. Wouldn't you say, son? Indeed, yes it is. By the look on your face, I'd say you're already feeling it. You're not gonna make it in this line of work without a big old stomach, son. Heh. I'm a huge fan of this country's food. One taste and you never forget it. I'd like to bring the entire cuisine back with me if I could. This is the first time we've seen you in how long, and you're talking about food? First thing you asked when you opened was, is the restaurant by the seaside still open? For goodness sake. Is your heart made out of stone? What, would you prefer we discuss the mundane? Why don't we talk about market development and our spice inventory? That's not what I meant. It's hot. My parents' relationship is on thin ice, but the air feels like it's on fire. It's much too hot. My dad loves this seaside restaurant. It actually specializes in fish, but he always asks for meat. Though always isn't very often. He's out of the country most of the time, so we rarely eat together as a family. For that reason, I can usually put up with a little heat for a family gathering. Today, however, is awkward. Go on, son, dig in. You can't find food this good back home. As you say, every course, the table is lined with meat, meat, meat. Oh my god, you're killing me here. I want some meat. Even I'm starting to feel heavy in the gut. At this rate, I might turn into meat myself. Oh my god, the story is teasing me. I just want meat. I want dead animals in my mouth. What kind of meat would I turn into, though? I guess beef, maybe, if the meal keeps on like this. Just how much food are you planning to order? I can't believe you. Why did I ever marry you? Come now, we're out as a family. You could stand to be a little more pleasant. Who do you think is making me unpleasant? Now. Aw, they're cute. From time to time, our eyes meet. But every time they do, we both avert our gaze. This goes on throughout the meal. My father invited him to lunch. Dad introduced him as his right hand, so I assume he's also a traitor. His eyes are somewhat narrow, his posture perfectly upright. He looks very no-nonsense, and not especially affable. Frankly, he kind of scares me. What? No, he's cute. Hey, Dad. Are we going anywhere after lunch? I figured since we're all together, maybe we could take a walk or visit someplace out of town. Actually, I've got a letter to write after this. A letter to one of the bigwigs back home. So I'm planning to head straight back to the trading post. Oh, okay. Can't say I'm especially surprised. What do you want me to do? It's work, and it has to be done. If I could get an audience with him in person, maybe this wouldn't be necessary, but that's not possible. So I have no choice but to write a long, long letter. Oh yes, Pauline. If you're going on a walk, bring him along. I'm sure he's tired of putting up with me day in and day out. What? Oh no, I'm... Hold on now. Can you please leave Pauline out of this? She has things she needs to do too. What's the big deal? You want to know about an area, ask someone who lives there. It's the best way to learn. Besides, you'll stick out like a sore thumb wandering around on your own, son. But I couldn't... You don't mind, do you, Pauline? Not at all. God, you are the most inconsiderate man, Mom says, then leans in and whispers to me. Listen to me. Do not let your guard down around that foreign man. My father is, as a matter of fact, a foreigner, and the man he brought to lunch is from the same country. This is a park. Indeed it is. It is a park. Such conversation. My assignment to show this man around town is, to be honest, going quite horribly. This is a park. No, just no. Couldn't you come up with anything better, Pauline? But I don't know anything about the history of this park. In fact, I don't know much of anything about this town's history. I sort of just walk around every day, not paying it much mind. Wouldn't someone more knowledgeable make a better guide? I can't do it. Don't ask this of me. Also, He doesn't talk very much, and he's got this perpetually stern look on his face. He really does scare me. Don't worry, Mom. Your daughter won't mistakenly fall for a foreigner. Foreigner. I don't know where that came from. I don't know. He's cute. I don't know if it would be a mistake. Besides, you seem perfectly happy 3 years from now or whatever. At any rate, regardless of how I feel, I am still technically his guide. I've got to try a little harder. Also, I'm pretty sure the dad is, like, a giant shipper, right? No pun intended. He's like, yeah, go on a walk with my daughter. Don't worry about it. It'll be hilarious. Though I know it won't be easy. And then, there's a fountain. There is indeed a fountain. There's a fountain. Again, no. Seriously, Pauline? He has eyes. I'm sorry. I'm not much of a guide. Maybe my dad could just show you around instead. No, don't worry about it. I think you're doing just fine. In fact, I'm sorry you got roped into this. I doubt you much enjoy having to walk around town beside someone like me. What? No, that's not it at all. Oh, is that so? I'm glad to hear it. Here's an idea. Rather than guide me, how about this? Why don't you show me what you usually do, the places you normally go? Do you really want to see that? I prefer to see the town through the eyes of a resident. See it for what it is, instead of what makes good sightseeing. Alright, then, I have to get ham sandwiches from the shops near here. Having lunch on the wall by the fountain is the most wonderful thing. Wait, didn't you two just eat? You were just like, man, there's so much meat on my plate, I feel like I'm gonna explode. And now you're gonna go get ham sandwiches? Make up your mind! Look over there, see the butcher shop and the bakery next to it? I'll buy bread from the bakery, bring it to the butcher, get a few slices of ham, and put it on the bread. It's absolutely to die for. Wait, it's just like a ham sandwich, like bread, ham, bread. I feel like for a sandwich to be absolutely to die for, it probably not some other ingredients, like lettuce or cheese or tomato or something. Ha, but you just had a huge lunch. See, this merchant is talking my language. Also, I like how we still haven't gotten his name. Did we? He might have given his name when he met up with Bestia, but I then immediately forgot it. I don't know. Could go either way. I'm not getting one right now. Okay, well, at least she's sensible. Also, please don't think I'm as carnivorous as my dad. Sorry, I didn't mean to imply any such thing. I mean, you say that, but like, your ideal sandwich is, like, bread, meat, bread. Like, even I put vegetables on my sandwiches, and I'm, like, as carnivorous as it comes. Jeez. Wait, hold on. Did he just smile? Okay, so funny aside about my carnivorous nature. When I was a child, my mother, who's a vegetarian, wanted to try and seduce me onto the path of vegetables. And so she was like, so Teo, you know, ham comes from pigs, and beef, it comes from cows. Thinking, of course, that the young, impressionable me would find this horrifying and then would swear off eating meat forever. And me, the enterprising young 6-year-old or whatever, thought deeply to myself for a moment, then turned to my mother and said, so what could we make from our cat? And that was the moment my mother realized I was never going to become a vegetarian. He did. It was a small one, but he did. He can actually smile. Being human, that should be obvious, but it's kind of strange seeing him do it. Maybe, just maybe, we'll be able to get along, even just a little bit. Do you mind if I ask you a question? Sure, go right ahead. Could you tell me about your home country? I've asked Dad, but he won't tell me very much. Come on, how about it? I'm really curious. Also, I can't hear myself over this music. I don't think their sound editing guy did a very good job, because, like, sometimes the music is, like, really loud, and sometimes it's, like, really soft. He probably doesn't know very much himself. What, about his own homeland? Some don't. What do you... How about the fountain? I'd like to get a closer look at it. At the spot you say you like to sit. Okay? What was that just now? Did he dodge my question? Is there something that he doesn't want to get into? From this angle, it looks like the fountain sitting atop the ocean. Ah, yeah, it does. It does. If you want, we can go to the beach. Just a straight walk from here. No, I like this view. The sea's a pretty color here. You can clearly see the white of the fountain upon it. Sea's a different color than the fountain? It is. In fact, the sea is often changing colors itself, but out on the water, it can be easy to overlook. It can be the color of emeralds, or deep blue like sapphire, or almost black like obsidian. The sea has a face, and with it, many expressions. Huh. I'd like to see that. Maybe I'll ask Dad and get him to take me out on his ship. You have quite the adventurous spirit. Not many women say that they want to ride a ship. You think? I want to go everywhere I haven't been before. I want to see for myself that the world extends beyond this town. Ah, that's a fine ambition. Hopefully, the time will come when anyone can have access to a ship with relative ease. He actually smiles quite a bit, I guess. And we seem to be talking pretty comfortably, too. He's a lot more friendly than he looks. He appears almost noble, the way he looks out at the sea, his gaze steadfast and unwavering. Oh dear, that was close. He almost deceived me. He's a foreign man, and I'm simply his guide. You mustn't think you've grown close to him just because you were able to hold a brief conversation. By the way, pardon me, yes? That outfit you're wearing. Oh, this? Oh, yes, it's absolutely splendid. My dad brought it back for me. It's of peculiar design, with unusual accessories. The moment I saw it, I said, oh my. Oh my, I said. It's so pretty, I just want to show it off to everyone. I see. Oh, it's just so magnificent. He actually has a decent eye for clothing. I guess he has more in that head of his than meat. Actually, I brought back that outfit. Huh? When I heard I was going to meet my boss's daughter, I thought it would be best if I brought some kind of gift. So I had the tailor imitate the style of my homeland. I'm delighted it's to your liking. What? Hold on a second. Yes? So you're saying these clothes I'm fawning over were given to me by you? And you had them made for me? Indeed. And completely oblivious, here I am wearing them now. More precisely, you've been wearing them since lunch. Why didn't you say something before? This is humiliating. I want to bury my head in the sand. But I thought you liked them. I do indeed, but having never met you, I wasn't sure what colors you'd liked, but I was relieved to see you wearing them. They look nice on you. He says with a smile. He's always standing up perfectly straight, always looking stern and no-nonsense, and he kind of scares me. But he's a gentleman. I'm gonna go change. Wow, that's harsh. Man, imagine how bad that must feel. It's like, chick is like, man, these clothes are super sweet, and you're like, oh yeah, I got them as a gift for you. And she's like, I'm gonna go get changed. That's gotta sting, man. I'm gonna go change. I'll be back in 5 seconds, so just wait there. 5 seconds is infeasible. Oh god, help me, Mom. I really, really need your help. Because my heart just skipped a beat. For a foreign man. Oh, is that so? Very well, then. Oh no, thank you for the information. I really appreciate it. And don't worry about me, I'll keep safe. Goodbye. Shortly before I arrived at the village, a beast appeared. It killed a number of villagers and then disappeared. Ever since then, the village hasn't been itself. There's a cloud of gloom hovering over it, fear visible in everyone's eyes. At first, I thought their fear was of the beast returning, but that's not quite right. Their troubles with the beast are, in fact, still ongoing. Ah, Javi.
Hey. Hear you were asking around about the beast?
Yeah. Talking about the beast is taboo. People are going to push you away even harder now.
Though, I guess, you are leaving in a few days.
People are going missing. Your beast problem is still going on, isn't it?
Huh.
After asking around, I'm beginning to piece things together. When the beast first appeared, you chased it away. However, later, the beast came back, killing villagers. After that, the beast disappeared, but villagers began disappearing too. Once a week, someone would just be gone. See, that's kind of interesting, because I had assumed that the way the mansion did its, like, wish-granting nonsense was it just kind of messed with, like, luck, if that makes sense. Like, if there's somebody who is already gonna be, like, getting lost in the woods, it would sort of, like, nudge them in the right direction. But it sounds like it was taking on a much more active role if people are just, like, going missing from the village, and not, like, people who have good cause to necessarily be wandering into the forest or getting lost or whatever. Like, these are people who are actively terrified of getting killed by the beast, and yet they're still disappearing. And even as the weeks passed, none of them ever returned. The people of the village think the beast is responsible. They think it's kidnapping villagers. Kidnapping is a strong word. That's right. The village is under the beast curse. So you're better off forgetting about this place and the savage beasts and the savage beast that dwells nearby. You don't belong in a place like this. Go back to your hometown where it's peaceful. That's the kind of life you deserve. Javi,
what?
I want you to be honest with me about something. Where does...
I won't tell you.
Why not? They told me that you would know where the beast is, Javi. I heard from the other villagers that you once chased the beast.
Sure you didn't mishear him?
No, I'm positive. You know where the beast ran off to, where its hideaway is. You chased after it, found its den, and then you came back. That's what I heard. Didn't you? Why did you keep that from me? When you told me about the beast, I asked you to tell me everything you knew, Javi. But you brushed me off, said you didn't know anything. Said that I should talk to someone else. When in reality, you know more about it than anyone else. Tell me why. Why did you hide that from me? What were you thinking, as you watched me frantically asking around the village for more information? Were you enjoying yourself? Tell me, why are you always so mean to me? Shut the hell up! Like I could tell you? Like I could actually tell you that? What'd the village tell you about me? Did it go something like this? That the kid couldn't even take revenge for his parents? He's a damn coward? I'm sure you heard that one plenty from everyone. Now you think that I'm a coward too. I don't... Yeah, it's true, I went after the beast. I chased it down the night it killed my parents. Hiding around back, I saw it slip into the forest. So I went after it, chasing it until I reached its den. I despised that bestia with everything I had. It murdered my mom and dad. I murdered my friends, the kindly priest, every decent person in town. I needed to get revenge for what it had done. It was my duty to bring retribution upon the beast that stole everything from me. So I tried to confront the bestia, but I couldn't do it. Not only could I not stand up to it, as soon as I turned around and I saw its eyes, its bloodshot eyes and black irises, I couldn't move. Javi, yeah, that's right, I was a coward. I watched as it killed my parents, and even followed it home. But I couldn't do anything. Anything except run, flee, screaming in terror. That was all I could do. Javi, that doesn't make you a coward. If the beast really was that terrifying... But I was supposed to stand up to it. That's what the rest of the village would have wanted. For someone to eradicate the bestia. When I came back, having accomplished nothing, everyone was so harsh. You coward. What do you even go out there for? Constant ridicule. What right do they have to... If they really wanted him gone, they could all go together and... No one's got that kind of courage left. They're all waiting for someone else to speak up. Someone to stand up and say, let's go kill the beast. Well, that's Pauline's job. But no one has the guts to take that initiative. Could have been me, but... The moment I fled back to the village in fear, I lost that qualification. You think that was just me being mean? Huh? That I didn't tell you where the beast dwells. You think that was just me harassing you? No, that seems like perfectly legitimate information to withhold if you think she's going to make really bad decisions upon hearing it. I've seen the beast. I know how scary it is, and I know how dangerous it is. And you think I'd tell you where it is? I know good and well what you're thinking. That the guy you're looking for might have been taken by him. And you want to go to its den to see if he's there? Knowing that, do you really think I'd tell you? If you go, it'll kill you. You don't have any evidence anyway? Nothing that points to that guy being taken by the beast? You don't need to put your life on the line for something like that, something so uncertain. Even if by some chance he was taken by the beast, there's no way he'd be alive. That's what the beast does. No one comes back alive. But you came back alive, Javi. Which means there's no saying for sure either way. That's just because I ran away immediately, but even if he did manage to escape, that's all the more reason not to check the beast's den. I want to know for sure whether he's alive or dead. Somewhere, in a little corner of my heart, part of me thinks that he might just actually be dead. I have to have faith, but I'm so close to cracking, to thinking he won't ever come back to me. Then, why don't you just give up on him already? Without knowing for sure, I can't let go. I'll debate with myself forever, until I die on old lady, about whether or not he's still alive. That's how my life will end. You want closure? You want to know for sure whether he's alive or dead, right? Even if he is dead, you'll be satisfied just knowing it? Right. Which is why I want to, at least, follow any possible leads. There might not be anything saying he's there. But it is true that the remains of the ship he was on washed up in this village. If he wandered the area, and ended up at the beast's den, where he was killed, then I'll let go. So please, Javi, tell me where the beast dwells. Make this the last time. Huh? Even if you find no trace of him at the beast's den, even if you don't figure out whether he's alive or dead, you'll give up your search for him. You'll assume he's dead. If you don't reach some conclusion, you'll just keep searching, keep going to dangerous places, keep putting yourself at risk. I want you to stop that. To stop, go back to your town, and live a normal life. Settle on an answer. If you can promise me that, I'll tell you where the beast's den is. Okay, I promise.
This will be the last place I look. Two more things. First, I'm going with you.
What? But I thought, isn't it dangerous?
Exactly. I can't let you go alone.
Javi,
I have to go with you and make sure you don't do anything stupid.
Alright, fine.
And the other one is,
you will not enter the den.
You don't understand just how dangerous the beast is. It knows no mercy. It indiscriminately attacks any human it sees, so you can't let the beast find you. You just examine the den from the outside. And when you're done, back to the village. Understood? You need to promise me this.
Okay. Oh, right, one more thing.
Huh?
I thought it was just two things.
This is less of a promise, and more something that would be nice. I decided, when we make it back to the village, I actually would like if you could take me to your hometown.
Javi!
I'll figure out some way to get permission, and I'll do my best to not be a burden on you. I'm just a kid, and there's not a whole lot I can do even in a better place. But I'm surprisingly skilled with my hands. If you have work for me, I'll do anything. So, there's that.
Yes, yes, of course I will.
We'll go back to my hometown together, and I'll show you all around. You can get some great ham sandwiches there. We'll eat them together in the park.
You've told me that already.
Heh, are you ever not hungry, lady?
Ah, you laughed. You just laughed, Javi.
Whoa, back off. I did not laugh.
Nope, you definitely laughed.
You're kinda cute when you laugh, Javi. Come on, do it again. Go on, like this. Shut up! Stay back!
No, stop it! Don't touch my cheeks!
I wanted to see it again. I am not your plaything. Anyway, we set out tomorrow. We will return before it gets dark, you will keep your promises, and you will not do anything dangerous.
Got it?
Promise. Thank you, Javi. I don't need your thanks.
Thank you?
That thank you is not for him agreeing to tell me where the beast's den is, but because I can see that Javi's trying to save me. His care calms the turbulent waves that have been crashing inside me. I was always anxious. I always believed. I always thought I'd see him again. But I also realized that I was practically living a fantasy. I was just too stubborn to admit it. I certainly won't be able to change how I feel immediately. I'll probably continue loving him. Nevertheless, Javi's words resonate comfortingly with me. I can see, if but vaguely, a new path, a new way of life appearing before me. That's what he did for me. I'll make this the last time. My final attempt to find him. No matter the outcome, I will stop stubbornly believing he's still alive. And then, I'll find happiness on a different path.
Alright, water.
Master?
Master.
Ah, you have awakened. You gave me quite the startle. Do you not remember? You suddenly started staring off into the distance, and you would not respond to anything I say.
So we definitely just said that the last two scenes that Javi was in. So between that and his hair color, I feel like he has, like, greater relevance to the overarching story than is immediately evident. So it's possible that Javi is, like, Mel's reincarnation?
I don't know. I'm, like, basing this off of very loose threads.
But like I said, there are just so few sort of pieces in the puzzle right now that I have to go off of either, like, either things are going to be super obvious, or I have to go for, like, whatever connections I can find. So that's my current theory. I would not at all be surprised if it holds zero water, but that's what I'm going for now.
Hehe, I thought you were playing a prank on me.
Your hand?
Oh yes, I did not let go of it.
If I had, we would be in quite the predicament.
Someone approaching the mansion, you say? You saw them? Those images were not shown to you by me. If you saw something, then it was by your own powers. But if you think about it, that is not a thing unusual. You are, after all, the master of this house. You should, in all actuality, be able to do anything I can do by yourself, master. So it is very possible you could have knowledge that I do not. Now, let us return to the mansion's tale. After the second beast paid a visit, Bestia began to destabilize again. The white-haired girl would soothe his heart, but the calm was only ephemeral. He was like a cracked glass ball. If you dropped him, that would be the end. If you put too much force into handling him, he would shatter. He was very difficult to care for, and cracks do not heal. The damage still remains, even if the two sides appear to be held together firmly in place. Furthermore, they slowly, gradually, and without intervention spread. The beast appeared to be afraid of someone's voice. He would on occasion stare into empty space and shout, cover his ears, and groan. One day, he shattered all the windows in the mansion, crushed the silverware I had just polished to a shine, and destroyed all the mirrors. I assumed he did not want to see his beastly self. More. There's more. There's still more that reflects my image. Windows, mirrors, vases, dishes, they all show my reflection. What are you doing? I have no need of anything that reflects me. You can understand that, can't you? Oh, this is interesting, because in present day, there was a scene where the master and the maid were both going past, it was like a window or a mirror or something, and neither of them had a reflection. So this is the second time that reflections have sort of come up in a relevant context. So, I'm wondering if there's a link there. Why, you're going to cut your hands like that. Tracing the wall with her fingers, the white-haired girl approached Bestia. She stretched her spindly fingers out towards the beast's rugged hands. His hands were wet with blood from his frenzied attempts to destroy anything reflective in the house. Look at all these cuts. Stop. You're going to dirty your hands. Get back! No, I will not. It's no use. No matter how many times you call me human, the mirrors tell another story. Not just the mirrors. Everything reflective shouts beast at me angrily. Look at how precarious I am. It's hideous. Pitiful. I thought it was all over when I protected you from the beast. But that image keeps coming back to me. The sight of another beast clinging onto me. I can hear its voice. It says I was only ever a beast.
Voice? Whose voice?
So you don't know. So you can't hear it. You're fighting against something beyond the limits of my perception. Fighting. Now, if only it were a fight. It speaks the undeniable truth. As I have said before, you are not a beast. You look like me. I am certain of it. Your eyes. What? Your red eyes. They show you nothing, but they show me what I am. They show me the difference between us. Wait, is he gonna get mad that her eyes are reflective? This ends really poorly, doesn't it? Are you afraid of my eyes? If my eyes cause you fear, if you can see them in your reflection, if you can see in them your reflection, then you're welcome to destroy them. Rip them from me, with your own hands. I have no need of them, after all. Why would you go so far for me? You... That's pretty generous. Even if I was blind, I would be hard-pressed to tell one of my friends, oh yeah, by the way, feel free to rip out my eyes. That feels like a boundary that I would be at least hesitant to cross. The voice says that you're laughing at me, that deep down, you ridicule me. Do you believe that? After all the time we spent together. I don't know. I'm starting to lose confidence. I believe you. I think I believe you. But I find myself wavering. I'm losing sight of myself, and of you, of everything. In all my memories, I'm a beast. The voice says I was always this way. Which, I suppose, means I'm a beast. Can't be anything but. Do not trust the voice. Trust me instead. I do not want to make another mistake. To do something like run away, because I am so weak-willed. Oh, interesting. Does she remember the events of Door 1 now? I do not understand this woman. She's so pure-hearted, so beautiful, like hope personified. I want to understand, to believe her. I was sure I could do it, but I keep failing. Why am I losing my grip on everything? Are words not enough to convince you? What? Are words not enough to convince you that you are not a beast? And see for yourself. Feel for yourself. There is but one difference between us. What are you doing? I assume our skin and our hair and our eyes are different colors. But those do not count as a difference. The only thing that differs between us is our sex. Hold on. In his utter shock, Bestia was frozen in place. And he was right to be surprised. The sound of rustling fabric shook the air in the Forlorn Mansion. She had placed her hand on the sleeve of her garments and began to disrobe. Before long, gaze upon me. She was standing there completely undressed. Her body was incomparably beautiful. Slender, not an ounce of excess fat on her. The sight of her was impressive, almost divine. Even I let out a gasp when I saw her. See for yourself. This was the first time Bestia had seen the white-haired girl unclothed. Though they slept in the same bed, as I said before, they did not have a physical relationship. She grasped his unmoving hand and guided it towards her. She moved his hand down across her flesh, along the curve of her shoulder, down her arm, and pressed it against her chest firmly enough for him to feel her beating heart. Do you think this caused a stirring within him? Hehe. Is there any man for whom the touch of a woman's skin would not? Especially one as beautiful as her. However, he was not aroused. Why do you think that was? Because a beast cannot lust after a human? I believe you know the answer. Are you crying? Could you smile for me? What? I want to see your smile. Like this? I'm not sure I'm doing a good job.
No, you're doing fine. Your smile is so pretty. It calms me, warms my heart. I think I know someone somewhere who has that same smile. Oh, interesting. Okay, I'm back to thinking Bestia is the protagonist reincarnation. I don't even have confirmation that the protagonist is, like, persistent through the stories. I'm, like, basing this off, like, a couple of lines in the opening monologue. So it's possible I'm just, like, completely off base here. But assuming that that's true, after that line, I'm, like, leaning back towards Bestia being the protagonist, then, can't remember, what was the kid that I like's name? Started with a J, it was four letters long. Javi? That sounds right. I'm leaning more towards Bestia than Javi now, but I think it could go either way. Thank you for seeing me off. Don't mention it. I learned so much about this town thanks to you. You made my stay here quite enjoyable. What's the matter? You're looking rather glum. I wonder... I wonder why the sea exists. I was born in a port town, so it's always been there for me. This huge, never-ending, expansive, magnificent ocean. Far too big for a single, measly little human like me to cross. It's so pretty. It is. I feel like I understand why you like the sea. But right now, I can't help wondering why God created such an enormous sea. Why he didn't make the world smaller. I'm sorry. I'm talking nonsense. Not at all. I'll probably be back eventually. That's just part of the job. And will you have lunch at the seaside restaurant again? Haha, quite likely. And I bet it'll be mostly meat, too. Was your stomach able to handle it? I'll train up for next time. Your ship is going to embark soon. Yeah. Will people get mad that you're not helping them prepare? Most likely. Then you should hurry off. Yeah. Pauline. I just wanted to thank you again. I appreciate you taking so much time to show me around. Is that all? No. Don't know why, but I was considering leaving without telling you this. I'd like you to tell me. I feel better if you turned me down. What? My homeland is only getting more isolated. Unlike your country, mine is not eager to associate with the rest of the world. Oh, is he Japanese? 1700s. I thought the Sakoku was already in place in the 1700s. I was like 1600, I thought it was implemented. I just took a class on Japanese history, so I feel like I should probably know this. Because I know it was revoked mid-1800s, because the Perry thing. But I can't remember like when the borders started getting closed more formally. Anyway. I probably don't even have their patronage anymore. What I'm saying is that I have absolutely no stability. I can't even say for sure whether I'll be back. So, you're right. There's nothing but obstacles. I'm sure my mom would be opposed as well. But I've fallen for you. The way you look staring out at the sea, the shape of your lips when you smile at me, the kindness in your voice. The more time I spend with you, the deeper I fall in love with you. The whole world could separate us, and these feelings would not change. Well, damn, you beat me to it. If I'd waited, I don't think you would have ever gotten to it. I'll say it myself, too. I love you, Pauline. I fell for you the moment I first saw you. Now kiss. I promise. We will meet again. I promise. I'll be waiting. Thank you. It's visible in both of our eyes. This love, strong enough to wash away all our tribulations. It's all right there, plain as day, in each of our eyes. Mine and his. Also, I wonder if there's any significance to the fact that we're getting narration from Pauline, like, first person. Or if that's just, like, a storytelling convenience. Did you hear something? Huh? It sounded like someone's voice. No, I didn't hear anything. Must have been your imagination. Oh. You want to turn back, lady? Huh? You're looking nervous. Let's keep moving. Ah, there is one thing. What? My name isn't Lady. It's Pauline. This again? Lady is so distant. I don't like being called that. So, call me Pauline. Polly. How's that? Can I call you Polly? Oh, come on. I'd really rather you called me Pauline. I'm an only child,
so I've always wanted a younger brother or sister. Polly makes it sound like I'm the younger one. I'm not your brother, and I'm not a child. You called yourself a kid yesterday, though. That's not what I meant. Oh, fine, you can call me Polly. It's not my full name, but I'm glad you're calling me something other than Lady Javi. Heh, that's what I'll do. Ah, you laughed. Be quiet. You're no fun. There's a mansion up ahead, standing atop the cliff. I can't say why exactly, but I feel like it's something that shouldn't be there. Huh, maybe it's moving. I had assumed the mansion was stationary, but it's also possible that the mansion, like, teleports. What do you mean? It feels out of place in this area, and something feels off about it. Like it's somehow ethereal, and could disappear at any moment. No, I'm probably just overthinking things. Sorry, that was stupid of me to say. It's okay. We still can't see the mansion Javi's talking about here. Just dense, overgrown forest. Also, here's a question. Why didn't they bring, like, the whole town? Like, Javi was saying earlier that he doesn't have the qualifications because everyone thinks he's a coward. But despite the fact that she's an outsider, it's, like, feels entirely possible for Pauline to, you know, rouse everyone to battle. I feel like that's a viable strat when you're going up against, like, literally a monster. You probably want more than two people. But for some reason, I can sense we're approaching it. It's a strange sensation. Anxiety is bubbling up from deep inside me, and at the same time, I feel like I could burst into tears. Not out of fear, but familiarity. Oh, that's weird. Is she Nelly? That would be weird. Familiarity? I've never been to this country before. Everything I'm seeing is new to me. There's nothing at all for me to find familiar. Why, then? I'm gonna ask you one more time. Are you sure you want to do this? I am. You agreed not to go inside. Don't break that promise. It's okay. Don't worry. I'm sorry for putting you through this, making you relive unpleasant memories. But thank you for accompanying me when you have nothing to gain from it. Don't worry. I'll just look around. I'm only searching for a sign he was there. When I'm done, we'll all return to the village together. All right. Okay, now let's go. We push our way through the dark, dense woods. And then, like the world fading into view after a dream, a mansion appears before us. It rests quietly upon a cliff, against a backdrop of emerald ocean. This is the beast's den? It should, by all rights, be a magnificent scene, but the blue sky and jade sea clash with the building. It appears alone, isolated precariously from the rest of the world. Yeah, this is it. This is the mansion where the beast dwells. I can't remember if... Going back to the point about the mansion teleporting, I can't remember if there was any lines in the first door that would either confirm or deny that, because we have a fairly clear, like, location hook for the second one, right? Like, it's on this cliff. And it feels important enough that there's probably a line of dialogue in the first door either confirming or denying that, like, the house is on a cliff. And if it isn't on a cliff, then obviously it's in a different place. Because I don't feel like the geography is likely to change that dramatically in 100 years. Although I guess it's possible. Careful not to make any noise, we draw near to the house, this inexplicable structure sitting in between the forest and the cliff. The fluttering I feel in my heart does not seem to be caused only by fear of the beast. The weeds and plants growing unchecked around the house are tall enough for Javi to hide in. I imagine that's how he approached the mansion the first time, lurking in the overgrowth. Say, have the people of the village thought about leaving this area? Moving somewhere else, away from the beast's den? Only those with enough savings can do it. Leave without money and you'll just die in a ditch somewhere. Everyone's made their lives here in the village. We have farmland, cattle, ships. It's not easy to let all that go. I mean, cattle and ships can be moved. Not everyone can just hop on a boat to another country like you, Polly. We're not wealthy. Sorry, I didn't mean to offend you. I know, I was being too harsh. You're just ignorant. So naive you believe the whole world is this perfect magical place. I'm not saying that's a bad thing. If you're capable of seeing the world like that, there's no reason you should look at it any other way. For as mature as you can be, Javi, you're also rather cynical. Well, pardon me. When you said you would take me to your town, that kind of made my day. There's nothing left for me in this village. You'll find plenty of new things, I'm sure. You can even make some friends in my town. After all, you've still got a long life ahead of you, Javi. Oh, death legs. Just make it a fun one. Make it sound like I'm about to throw myself off a cliff. I didn't mean it like that. We should try to keep quiet from here out. Ah, okay, got it.
As we draw closer to the mansion, I can see the ivy twisted across its stone walls. I press my back against the wall and take a few deep breaths. There's a window next to me. If there really is a beast, if there really is a terrible man-eating monster inside, I'm in danger if it catches me. Javi's eyes entreat me not to get any closer, but I have to see. I have to see if there's a mountain of corpses inside these walls. If there's even the slightest trace of him. I'm just gonna have a look. Peek from inside without being noticed. That's all I'm gonna do. When it's done, I'll go home. Through the window, I see a dimly illuminated hallway. Like the garden, the inside is desolate, but there's still the sense that someone lives here. It's not completely abandoned. Polly. Ah! I see something moving inside the mansion. I hold my breath so whatever is in there does not sense my presence, does not sense my gaze. And then... What? A shadow whisks past. No. Polly? Hey, Polly! What happened to being quiet? Open up! Please, open the door! Stop it, you idiot! What do you think you're doing? Please, open the door! Polly, you promised me. Have you lost your mind? The only thing in here is a... It's not a beast! Huh? It's not a beast! A beast isn't living in this mansion! You're wrong, it is. There's a beast in there. A bestia! Get away from the door! The beast... It's not a beast! Open the door! Open the... I knew it! I knew it! I was right! You're alive! You're alive! You're alive! I never stopped believing! I knew you wouldn't die! Would you... Yukimasa? What's a Yukimasa? Oh, that's the guy's name. Okay, so probably Japanese? I don't think I've heard anyone named Yukimasa before, but... There's at least Japanese sound structures. I had faith you were still alive. I wanted to prove it, and I was right! This is ending really poorly. Like, this is ending really poorly. $10 says, like, somebody's about to die or something. I'm so glad I had faith. I'm so glad I didn't give up. I missed you so. All this time, I've never stopped thinking about you. I never stopped imagining our reunion. Yukimasa, I'm so glad you're alive. Stop it, Polly. Get away from him. That's... The beast! You'll kill me if I don't kill you. And so I must show you that I will. I must show you that I'm serious. I must kill you, or you won't understand. Wait, what's going on? I'm super confused. Is he like a shapeshifter? Or did he always look like that? I'm super confused right now. I mean, I guess my guess about like his form being hidden by shadows was like... There's a plot twist associated with it. Like, I guess I was right. Something's happening. Not sure what's going on. You just won't understand. If I don't show you firsthand, you just won't understand. Oh, this is a flashback. These are like the lines that the beast was saying when he originally killed the merchant. Was the merchant the beast all along? I'm so confused. I'll make you understand. I'll make your flesh and bones understand. Kill, I'll kill you, I'll kill you! That's it, cry for me. Beg for your life. Pray for my mercy. Weep. And struggle, and suffer, and die. Look at this. No one can stand up to me. Humans have no chance against beasts. Yukimasa? What's wrong? What? What's the matter? It's me, it's Pauline. I came to find you. I've missed you so much. Oh, man. The other bestia he killed was Pauline? Jesus. Fuck. Yukimasa? I'm sorry. I still don't understand your language. Oh, my God. The issue is that he was talking in Japanese? That's why no one understood the beast? Good God.
Okay. I will retract my statement earlier about the twists being too easy to predict. I did not see this coming, and I totally could have. All right, I'm back on board. I'm excited again. I'm hyped.
Stop it, Polly! Don't go after him!
Polly!
Why are you running from me? Don't you recognize me? It's Pauline, your love. What? Why? Your katana. Why would you point that at me?
Wait, that's like this secret magical weapon that always stays sharp? It's Japanese steel, folded 1,000 times? Am I being memed?
You're scaring me. What's gotten into you? Hey, what's the matter? Yukimasa, do you know who I am? What happened? You used to be able to speak my language so fluently. Let's talk. What do you say? Put the thing away, please. It's dangerous. What? Why? You cut me. So hot. Why? Yukimasa, it's me, it's Pauline. Open your eyes. No, stop. Yukimasa, please stop this. I'm begging you.
Okay, maybe it's not Japanese. Maybe he's just going crazy.
Why would you do this to me? Stop this, Yukimasa, stop this.
His blade, held high above my head, glimmers. Why, he's the beast? Tell me, Yukimasa, did you kill all those villagers? Are you going to kill me? Why?
Please, stop. Yuki, it's me. It's Pauline. Please open your eyes. Let's go back to my town. I never got the chance to ask if you wanted to move my country. Then we wouldn't have to wait so long to see each other. What do you think, Yukimasa?
Burn in hell.
Why? Fuck, dude. Man, the fact that they spent so much time on Pauline's arc makes so much more sense now. Man, that's super sweet. I was expecting just like a simple sort of like revenge arc where Pauline like finds out the beast killed her lover and then he gets his, you know, karmic retribution for his sins. Despite his, like, earnest attempts to redeem himself. But no, I got played super hard. Alright, this is sweet. I'm hyped.
Tell me, why?
Although I'm sort of interested now to see how they resolve Yukimasa's arc.
What happened here?
I am grateful that you cannot see, because you would certainly think me a beast if you were able to see this. Because you cannot see, you do not know what I look like. But I do know. Another beast like me broke into the mansion. Was it?
I protected you! Did I not? I protected you! Say that I protected you, that I did this for you!
Actually a beast? I can hear a woman's voice. I can't keep my eyes open. I wonder who she is. They seem like they're really close. Did you choose someone else? Then you could have just said so. I wouldn't be angry. We've been apart for so long. But this does kind of hurt. It hurts. I can't take it. Just once, could you turn back and say my name? I proved it, that you're still alive. We were lovers, weren't we? So why? You said you wanted a peaceful life. I can't take this. God damn.
So where's the rest of the story play out? Because we still have Javi's arc and Yukimasa's arc to resolve. And white-haired girl has to do something. Maid is probably going to do something. So we still have, like, pieces to play. I assume Javi's going to, like, lead the town against him. And he's going to die horribly. But maybe the mansion has something to say about this, because this mansion seems invested in, like, his life going... like, in him, renouncing his non-stabby ways. So maybe he just kills a bunch of people. One way or another, this ends super poorly for now most of the rest of the cast.
It hurts so bad. Yukimasa. I can't take this.
What I want most is to spend a nice, quiet life with you. I don't need anything extravagant. Just an ordinary life, slowly growing older, having 3, maybe 4 children. We'd never fight, and eventually, before I knew it, I'd be an old lady. Thinking, ah, it was an uneventful life, but it was the best I could have asked for. That's the life I want. And what about you? Yes, I too wish for a peaceful life with you. Then maybe you shouldn't have stabbed her. Like, maybe that's not the best line to get that outcome.
But Polly, I couldn't... Again, I couldn't do...
I can't actually scream because it's 2 a.m. and I live in an apartment complex. And I have a roommate who would probably be opposed to me screaming at 2 a.m. Master, what is the matter? You look pale as a ghost. What, I lied to you? I have not told you a single falsehood, Master. Ah, about the beast? That means you were seeing her memories, then. Is that so? That must have been quite difficult to witness. But I assure you, I have told you no lies. Bestia was convinced he was a beast. And as a servant of this house, it is my responsibility to present my former master to you as he saw himself. This would have been a very different story, had you not discovered the truth. A beast meets a white-haired girl and learns humanity. That tale would have been far easier on you, I'm sure. By remaining in the dark, and seeing the story through his eyes alone, you would not have had to witness that poor girl's miserable death. And that, perhaps, would have been better for you. But the reality you observed through her eyes changes the truth of his tale. And it sounds like the visions you had did not run in parallel to the events I described for you, but took place slightly earlier in time. Which means that, yes, her fate was set in stone well before you ever saw it. I do have to wonder, though, why did Bestia believe the woman to be a beast like him? Perhaps it was because her hair, eye, and skin color were similar to his own. The poor young woman who called upon the mansion did indeed resemble Bestia. They were of a similar race. Half of her blood was of the same race as his. Yeah, because the dad came from the same country, right? But was that the only reason? Would that be enough for him to mistake her for a beast? I have my own theory. His memories may have played a role. I suspect Bestia was afraid the memories from when he was human would cause him to waver. But that is simply my own speculation. Perhaps he had simply lost his grip on reality. How well have you come to understand Bestia, Master? You do appear to think he was an ordinary human who believed himself to be a beast. But where does the line between man and beast truly lie? That I do not know. Master, if, like Bestia, you were to lose your memories and endure persecution and degradation until you broke, would you still remember those that you care for? Now, our tale is not yet over. The web of misfortune was tightly, oh, so tightly entangled. It could not be unraveled. Let us return now from her memories to the point we left off in our story. Just after the white-haired girl had disrobed, showing Bestia the difference between her and him. This was, yes, several days following the young woman's death. The blood in the hall had been cleaned up, and there was no trace of it any longer. He had made a tremendous mistake, though the only people aware of that mistake are you and I. There is, perhaps, a chance the white-haired girl had realized, but she knew nothing of the woman. So I entreat you not to fault the white-haired girl for trying to be kind to Bestia. She is without sin, in any and all times. Am I just supposed to take that as, like, red text? because, I don't know, even if she's blind, she's probably supposed to be able to find something sketchy about that entire exchange. But I digress. The beast, no, the man made the white-haired girl put her clothes back on. He seemed to have calmed down a bit. After examining her body and comparing it with his own, he was once again coming to think that he might not be a beast. In the past, he would have rejoiced to have proof of his own humanity. However, it was for him that the seed of several new doubts. He said, "I am human." "Yes." "Do you still believe this?" "I certainly do." "You are simply mistaken. You believe yourself to be a beast because of what the villagers said." "Why did they call me a beast?" If I were able to see, I could surely answer all your questions. But I cannot, so all I can offer you is my conjecture. Go on, tell me. I suspect that you do not come from this country. No, you do not come from this continent. You came to this country from far away, perhaps even across the seas. This land has been cast into turmoil by the war. Fortunately, no fighting reached the village, but it has blocked trade routes, stripped them of their independence, and cast a dark shadow over their hope. They are quite devastated, I imagine. And then you showed up. From what I have heard, this area is not particularly friendly to people from other countries, even less so to those from another continent. I doubt they knew much about distant lands, so they had probably never seen someone like you before. But in addition, you would have been wearied and worn. I guess you were emaciated, wasting away. Even so, that you did not look like yourself. Do you remember how you arrived at the village? When I woke up, I was on the beach. I don't remember anything before that. Yeah, that was another thing that I should have picked up on, was the line about the shipwreck was inconsistent with the way the merchant originally showed up at the mansion. Like, I don't think he mentioned anything about a shipwreck. I think he just mentioned, like, getting lost in the forest or something. No, I guess he came, like, asking for food and water. So it's not super suspicious, but I bet if I, like, went back and checked, there would be, like, one or two incongruous lines. Like, subtle enough to not seem out of place even after finding out about the shipwreck, but if you put them side by side, then I bet there's something. Okay, I didn't give this story the respect it deserved. I cast judgment too early. I mean, I did say that I, like, wasn't making, like, final judgments or anything, that I was willing to, like, let the story redeem itself, and it has done so brilliantly. I don't remember anything before that. My joints all ached, and I was incredibly thirsty. I was in so much pain, I sought help. But nothing I said got through to the villagers. Okay, yeah, so it's because he was talking in Japanese. I did not understand what they said either. But the one thing you did understand was that they were calling you Bestia. Right. And I also understood that that was the word they used to describe beasts. The way they looked at me, it wasn't normal, so I imagine at first they simply didn't want the trouble. They didn't actually think you were a beast. Simply that this wretched man, unfamiliar in appearance, who had washed ashore resembled a beast. Washed ashore. You were in an accident, were you not? While crossing the sea? I do not remember. I can't remember. No, I mustn't remember. If I'm not a beast, that means the other beast wasn't one either. What did the beast look like? It looked somehow familiar to me, somehow similar to me. Its hair color, skin color, eye color, and the way it spoke seemed vaguely familiar, which means it was... I cannot accept that. If I do, then that means I have done something terrible. No! What? They did call me a beast. I was, in fact, a beast. As I've been saying, that's because... Tell me I'm a beast, please! Let me remain a beast! How do you imagine he saw the world? I cannot even begin to fathom. But you can never know what someone else sees. And there's nothing to say that they see the same thing as you. As you and I have seen different things, so too did the man and his lover see different things. Or perchance the true shape of this world is visible only through the white-haired girl's sightless eyes. Do you think the reason he has so stubbornly rejected his human memories is because he had taken the life of his beloved? I personally believe that there was more to it than that. So they still haven't answered the question of who is the one talking into his head. Like, I'm still on the theory that it's the mansion, but someday you shall remember. You shall remember everything. I will not allow you to avert your eyes. Remember that you have always, always been a beast, incapable of saving anyone, only of taking. remember, and suffer. Agonize. Writhe. Anguish. Grieve. Suffer. Such a damn shame. Our homeland is but a stone's throw away, and they still won't let us in. Just how long are they going to maintain this stance? Regrettable, isn't it, son? Yes, I agree with you wholeheartedly, Captain Asama. We can make it this far on the white man's ship, but they give no response to our missives. I'm not sure it's even reaching the magistrate's hands. Is it so difficult to be even the slightest bit accommodating to your fellow countrymen? They seem to be treating the white men rather poorly as well. I hear they imprison them on a tiny man-made island. Oh, that's the port. There's like this one port that was like the only place that trade was allowed, even when Japan's borders were closed. And I think there might have been... And like, it was this like man-made island. There's like this bridge connecting it to the mainland. And it might have been a... There may or may not have been a prison on it, I'm not super sure. But yeah, I'm almost certain now that... I mean, I was already pretty sure based on the names and the... like, restrictions on trade, but I'm now even more sure that Pauline's dad and Yukimasa are from Japan. That's no way to make friends. Well, all things considered, we can hardly call this our homeland anymore anyway. For how many generations has your family lived overseas again? I'm the third. I see. Then I doubt you have any attachment to this land. That's not true. I may never have the opportunity to set foot on her soil, but my spirit dwells within this land. My grandparents have told me much about this country. Of her four rich, vibrant seasons and boundless beauty. I'm deeply grateful that you invited me on this voyage to visit her, Captain Asama. I have finally, if only at a distance, laid eyes upon my home. I cannot say when this era may draw to a close, but I hope the time comes when we can proudly proclaim her as our motherland. You can't find food this good back home? Haha, I eagerly await the day that becomes true. Indeed, as do I. I've lied to her. She believes I was born in the Orient. But in truth, I have never once set foot in that country. I was born in Europe. My family has not been permitted to return since my grandparents left. I can still remember as clear as day the look of profound regret on my grandfather's face as he departed from this world. He bequeathed unto me a katana. Oh, right, also the katana is sort of a dead giveaway. And on that day, that blade became the one object binding me to my homeland. I cannot bring myself to tell her that I am disallowed to return home. I did not want her to think that I had been forsaken by my country. That my country would do such a thing. However, some part of me believes that there was more to it than that. A smuggler? Yeah. I never would have expected it, not on this ship. One of the crew was conspiring with a government official. He hid unreported goods on board and delivered them in secret. What goods? Silver coins. Spanish coins trade for more than they're worth as currency. The official was sentenced to committing seppuku. But we are responsible for our own crew's punishment. I'm still trying to decide how to handle it. Have him commit seppuku as well. This sailor has brought shame upon the entire ship. If he is made to take responsibility for his actions, then perhaps we can minimize the damage to our reputation. You make a fair point. Unfortunately, he is not of this land. I doubt he is familiar with the ritual. Then I shall serve as his second and ensure he dies without issue. Have you lost your mind? I have been trained in the art. It is unlikely I should fail. You're not a samurai, though. I was born into a family of samurai. At least, it was until three generations ago. Yeah, I don't think that counts. But that blood still courses through my veins. You tell yourself that. Very well, then. That is how we shall do it. Also, that would be super messed up if you're, like, on a boat, right? And they're like, oh, by the way, in our culture, you have to kill yourself when you do the smuggling thing. You would be a little bit miffed. Like... not knowing the punishments when you get yourself into that situation feels a little bit sketch. I mean, you could argue that, like, he's in the wrong for smuggling, but I don't know. I don't know, man. We now commence the ritual seppuku of our fellow country crewman, Seedorf. Seedorf has, in violation of restrictions set in place by the shogunate, committed the grave crime of smuggling prohibited goods into the country. In order to atone for this betrayal of the trust of both nations, He vows to take his life here before you. You have any last words? I deeply regret that we should have to lose a companion with whom we have traveled the seven seas in this manner. Do it. Wasn't me. What? It wasn't me. I've been set up. I didn't smuggle anything. I don't know anything about any silver coins. I've been framed. Believe me, why should I have to slay... Wait, was it Yukimasa was the smuggler? Is that why he was so insistent on seppuku?
Wow. That's fucked up, dude.
Yukimasa. He said the accusations were false. Lies to escape punishment. I could not allow him to continue shaming himself and us when his fate was already decided.
God damn!
It would only serve to tarnish the ship's honor.
But...
An investigation was performed. It is our duty to trust those results.
You're right.
Yes. You're right. Good work. Now, this needs to be cleaned up.
Yes, sir.
I'm sure I was mistaken, but I would like to ask you anyway. Were you... smiling as you did it?
You... must have been seeing things. Okay, Yukimasa is fucked in the head. I guess it makes his transition into the beast more believable. But... yeesh.
Was that really the only reason I couldn't bring myself to tell her the truth?
What? What was that dream? Was that from my memories?
No.
Asuma, I've never met that man. Or that woman.
No. It wasn't me. I don't
remember. I don't remember anything. Not a thing. Not a single thing. I'm a beast. I'm a beast, not a human. I don't need those memories.
Okay, 1 second. I need water.
Are you there? Are you there? Where are you?
You know, at some point, I need to sit down and figure out why they're not telling me the white-haired girl's name. Because, like, fool me once, shame on you. Fool me twice, you're not gonna fool me again, right?
And, like, they very clearly spent a lot of effort hiding Yukimasa's appearance and name from me. So, I need to figure out why they're going to such lengths to hide the white-haired girl's name from me. But, I can't figure it out.
Especially, they were doing it even in the first one, right? And I thought it was a name that they're trying to hide from me. It's like, she has the same name as such and such, which none of the characters notice because they don't know such and such information. But as the reader, I have such and such information. But, now after the Yukimasa reveal, it, I guess, has, opened my eyes to them more, to the fact that there are, more options of, information they're concealing. One is that it's a red herring, which I strongly doubt. This is something that they've been spending a lot of effort, calling attention to. Another is, the example, then, is that Yukimasa's name was hidden not to have identity spoilers, because they'd already given him another name for the points where that was relevant, but to hide nationality. Because then, I guess, the fact that it's early 1700 let us make interesting assumptions about the political state of Japan at the time. But I don't know, I feel like that information might have been reasonable to give. Not unreasonable, at least. But that doesn't get me any closer to figuring out, what's up with the white-haired girl's name. But that's gonna keep me up at night. Let's just leave it at that. Come to me. Be with me. Peace. My peace. Where are you? Where have you gone? Why? Why are you not at my side? Don't remember anything. Stop remembering.
Is that a silver coin? Spanish silver.
Some weeks after we set off back west, I find a silver coin in the ship's hold. I don't know if it got overlooked or dropped when transporting the rest, but there's just one. The first thing I think when I find it is that I should report it to Captain Asuma. But instead, I slip the coin into my pocket and take my leave of the hold as if nothing ever happened. Not for the purpose of smuggling it for some extra cash. It only has extra value in the east. Back west, it's worth nothing more than its designated value as currency. So again, it's not for want of money.
Well, damn. It seems Seedorf might have been innocent after all. Perhaps so. If he had no hand in the smuggling, then I have done a horribly regrettable thing. No, as you said, an investigation was conducted. We had no choice but to believe the information we were given. You mustn't blame yourself. I feel bad for putting such an unpleasant responsibility on you. Not at all. Now, how do we handle this? I can't believe a silver coin was found in someone else's luggage. It would be best to handle this internally. Publicly, we have already made our amends to with Seedorf's death. That's true. It would be prudent to try and discover from where he is acquiring the coins, so as to prevent another such incident. Should one of our crew be caught smuggling again, he will not be the only one asked to take responsibility. I have great sympathy for you, Captain Asama. This is quite the headache. I can't imagine he would give up his connections just because we asked. We can force him. If he doesn't want to talk, then we can give him some encouragement. But I couldn't... Worry not, Captain Asama. I shall take care of the... dirty work. See, Yukimasa doesn't actually care about who's smuggling the silver coins. He just wants an excuse to torture people. You needn't trouble yourself with anything, Captain. Leave it all to me. Captain? Very well. I leave this in your hands, Yukimasa. Yes, sir. Also, if he's the one torturing, he can, like, make him say whatever he wants. Maybe implicate someone else, and then we get to kill that person, too. What fun Yukimasa's having. How are you feeling? Hey, untie me. What's the meaning of this? A silver coin was discovered in your luggage. Oh, wait. Was there, like, time that passed between those two scenes? Because if Yukimasa's the one who stuck the coin in the luggage, that's, like, even more fucked up. Like, I like how this arc is playing with, like, how bad I feel about Yukimasa's situation. Like, the parts with Bestia were, like, slowly ramping up his sympathy levels after, like, making him look really unsympathetic with the, like, murdering people wantonly. And then it's like, oh, he's trying to redeem himself. He's, like, trying to get better or whatever. And then, like, the reveal, and it's like, oh my god, that really sucks for him. And then we start finding out about Yukimasa's backstory, and it's like, oh, no, wait, no, he's actually just a terrible human being. Like, he basically just deserved everything that happened to him. Huh? A silver coin? Interesting. It would seem you have quite a knack for acting. Hold on, I don't follow. I thought the smuggling problem was taken care of. Seedorf wasn't the one doing the smuggling, it was you. Like hell? I've never seen any damn silver coins. This is some kind of mistake. Check my bags again. A coin was found in your luggage, regrettably. Captain Asama saw it himself. Lies! I swear I've never touched one. Is that so? I swear. Never once. Please believe me, I'm no smuggler. I've done good work, even on this expedition. You know I'm not someone who would get involved in smuggling. I don't know what kind of person anyone is. We may have known each other for years, but that doesn't mean I have any way of knowing what you think in private, how you feel, what kind of person you are. You smuggled the coins, didn't you? I didn't. I had nothing to do with it. Who is your supplier? I'm telling you, I'm no smuggler. It puts Captain Asama in a very uncomfortable position if you don't talk. We can't risk damaging our homeland's trust any further. I swear to God, I had nothing to do with it. So you won't tell? How can I tell you something I know nothing about? I see. You believe me? So it's very, very important information. Enough so that you can't give it up so easily. In which case, I'll just do what I have to do until you talk. What are you... Whenever you're ready to talk, just let me know. I'll stop right away. Hey, stop! What are you... Quite the thick fingers you have. Let go! What are you... But it's all meat. Your bones aren't thicker than anyone else's.
Ah! My finger!
Oh, don't start screaming just yet. That was just the first, your little finger. Next is your ring finger.
Stop! Please don't! I'm begging you!
Are you ready to talk?
I told you I don't know anything.
Too bad.
Ah! Ah!
Your middle finger.
Don't! Ah!
Your right hand is going to be useless if you don't start talking soon.
What do you want me to tell you? I swear, I had nothing to do with it.
What has you so stubbornly refusing to talk? Is your supplier really worth going to such lengths to protect?
No, I can't tell you what I don't know. That's...
Ah! All that's left is your thumb.
Help! Someone! Get me!
Just so we're perfectly clear, everyone on board knows what you did. No one's going to come to a smuggler's aid.
God, I can't take any more of this. Please stop.
Ready to talk? What will it be?
I'll talk. Okay, I'll talk.
If anything you tell me is a lie, you can consider your life forfeit. Are you ready to tell me the truth?
We will investigate the details of your confession. If you lie, we will find out. Understood?
But I...
Speak.
But...
Or can't you?
I don't know anything.
That's a shame.
Yeah!
Ah, well, you won't be using your right hand ever again. I mean bone seal, right? Although there are still five fingers on your left. Are you in pain? Do you want me to stop?
Yes, please.
All right.
Ah!
Four left. That is quite the face. I wish I could show it to you in a mirror.
What is wrong with you? You monster!
I'm not doing this because I want to. You're the one forcing my hand by refusing to talk.
Go on now, spit it out. You wouldn't believe anything I said anyway. How long have you been doing this?
You're the first.
Liar. You sick bastard.
It's the truth, though.
Then why? Why are you smiling? Ah!
Three left.
What'll it be? Will you tell me everything? No lies, no omissions?
Wasn't me. Wasn't me. I didn't do anything. Ah!
Two left.
It's surprising how easily they break.
No! Stop!
This is the last one.
It burns. It burns. My fingers are on fire.
Now, what next?
It burns, it burns, it burns.
Are you listening? Hello? This over a few broken fingers? Need me to wake you up? Let me tell you something. I'm the one who put the coin in your luggage.
Of course you don't know anything. Someone, anyone, get in here. The silver coin wasn't...
Don't go shouting things you'll regret. It's hard to fight back with your hands in that condition. Having trouble breathing, huh? Well, are you? You need air? I guess it's hard to talk with my hands around your throat, huh? Do you want air? Alright, then you can have some air.
Someone, anyone, please get it.
You just don't learn. I can see the words written in his face. Why? Why are you doing this?
Why?
That is a good question. I'm not even sure myself. Hey. Answer me. Well, damn. I missed the opportunity to use my katana. I tossed the man's body overboard. My story will be that he snuck out while I wasn't looking, and threw himself into the sea. As I watched the sack of flesh sink into the depths, I'm thoroughly shocked to realize I don't feel the slightest bit bad about what I've done. No regret, no remorse, nothing. I comprehend that things I've done are reprehensible, that they're evil. But that knowledge wasn't sufficient to restrain my urges. There's an itch I felt deep within my chest ever since the moment my blade sunk its teeth into Seedorf's neck. I don't know what to call it, but I feel like I'm floating. Like everything swirling about inside me has been unleashed, set free. There's also an edge of anxiety, though. If I continue down this path, what might I transform into? Despite feeling not the slightest bit guilty about the horrible things I've done, I still fear this life I've made slipping away from me. I want something to anchor me. What exactly am I? Is this what I wanted to become? The kind of man who can take another's life without flinching? Fully aware of his actions? And if that's truly what I am, perhaps it would make things easier if I did lose everything. Wait, did he cause the crash? That would be hella funny. Oh, don't scare me like that. And where did you pick up a word like... Ninja? God damn it. I thought we were done. I thought I was done having to pronounce that word. Like, I'm not even sure what that word is trying to be. Like, I'm gonna look it up after this video here. I'm gonna write it down on a sticky note. I have the sticky note right in front of me. N-I-N-T-J-E. Yeah, that's not a real word. If that's, like, actually an English word, I'm going to be blown off. My socks are going to be blown off. How's that idiom go? Anyhow, I'm going to be deeply surprised. I never took you for someone so pretentious. Haha, I'm sorry.
You just look so much like a rabbit there, the way you were tossing your head back and forth, looking around for me. Oh, you. Nitya is something you call a child. I'm not a little girl anymore. I'm sorry, really. Don't be so mad, Pauline. I'm not mad at all. It's been a year and a half. We finally get to see each other again. That we do. Did you have any trouble out at sea? Did you fall ill or get caught in a storm or run into any kind of danger at all? No, there was no trouble. Everything went fine, without incident. The sea god was watching over us, I suppose. By sea god, you mean like Hades. I don't know. See, the ironic part here is that Yukimasa would probably have a better time if he did get his memories back, because then he'd be like, oh yeah, murdering people for fun and profit. Like, sounds like a great time. I don't know what I was complaining about with this beast thing. It fits my, my motive scheme perfectly. What? What am I? Who am I? Who? What is this room? What are these colored windows? Were these here before? In the mansion? I know what that is. It's an angel. The angel is... It's looking at me and laughing. The angel is looking down on me and laughing. Oh, goodbye, stained glass window. You have served bravely. What are you doing? The angel's laughing at me. The angel... So The angel... You, where were you? I went to the kitchen to get a drink of water. You have nothing to worry about. I will not run away from you. I am not human. Am I? I'm not human. You are not a human. You are you. It's all right. I imagine it's quite disconcerting having lost your memories. But no matter what happens, you will always be you. And that is not necessarily a good thing. Don't be afraid. Are those the words of encouragement I truly wanted to hear? Am I afraid of being myself? And rightfully so. I don't know. Don't think about it. I am a beast. A beast with no memories. His psyche drifted erratically between human and beast. If he accepted himself as human, it might cause memories better left buried to return to him. If he accepted himself as a beast, in exchange for his memories, he would no longer be able to rejoin human society. The white-haired girl fervently supported him in these precarious times. I was quite amazed. I had never imagined she would grow to be such a strong woman. Nevertheless, God is a cruel master. For what strength he gave her spiritually, he took an equal part from her physically. Though she persisted, day in and day out, to stay by the man's side, one day she suddenly fell ill. With her in the throes of a high fever and not knowing the cause, he fell into a perpetual panic. There was no medicine in the mansion. They could hardly manage to put together sufficiently nutritious meals. Though there was no medicine, maybe there was something else that could make her feel better. However, everything he could think of required him to leave the house. Hey, is there anything you would like? Anything I would like? I'm considering visiting the village. I see. You're going to the village. I thought I might be able to get some medicine. But no one would come if they learned you were in this mansion. So, he was planning to put on a disguise, to enter the village as a person. The white-haired girl smiled when she heard his idea. She had, after all, always wanted him to think of himself as human. However, because she was so pure-hearted, she did not comprehend the full extent of the slaughter he had confessed to committing, the revenge he had taken on those who had chased him around, how sinister his cackling and furious his reaping. She did not grasp just how serious it was. She had faith that Bestia had kindness in his heart. If you cannot get any medication, then buy me some oranges, please. Oranges? This is a land blessed by the sun. You should be able to find some wonderful fresh oranges. Will that make you feel better? Yes, it should. Okay. Also, I don't know if they have any money. Like, not sure how Yukimasa is planning on paying for this medicine, but I have a hint it starts with a K and ends with Atana. Bestia's mind was made up. He would don the skin of a human for her, to protect the peace he had. He would return to the place that had left him with many painful memories. It was, to him, the source of his fear. Okay, so that might not be plan A for paying with the medicine, but, like, realistically, that's how it's gonna go down, right? Whenever he let his guard down, their shouts would play back in his mind. Bestia. 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 Hideous beast. Though he had physically conquered the people who lived there, Bestia's memories of the village still haunted him. But her health meant more to him than any of that. He was willing to cast aside his fear if it meant the white-haired girl would recover. The girl still in her bed, he made his way out of the mansion. He crossed the overgrown forest, pushing forward one step at a time, all the while trying to brush aside his apprehension, until he arrived at the village. This is where they called me a beast, where I was almost killed, and where I killed them. I look different than I did then. I'm dressed differently too, but can I play the part? Can I act a convincing enough human? I have no choice. There are no other villages. I can't let her die. Excuse me, could you answer a question for me? Village man is looking at me, only for a moment. But for me, that moment is torturously long. A faint look of panic crosses his face, perhaps in fear of my appearance. He's staring at me. Will he point his finger and call me a beast? Will the other villagers come to kill me? However, haven't seen you around here before. He didn't recognize me. Yes, I come from a faraway land, and I'm unfamiliar with this area, so... Haha, you're just like a nobleman. On a secret trip or something. Something like that. You look really pale, though. Searching for a doctor? Ah, yes, but not for me. My companion has come down with a fever. Sorry to hear it. Well, I'd love to introduce you, but he's out right now. And he won't be back for a few days. I see. And where might I be able to buy fruit? There's a shop just around the corner. Thank you very much. Don't mention it. Do take care, traveler. It's dangerous out there. Starting to attract attention, but not the same kind as before. They don't look at me with revulsion, hatred, or furious indignation. They're simply curious. The village feels different than last time. Could it have changed this drastically? Or is it because I really did look like a beast then, and now I look like a human? I don't know. Excuse me. Me? Yes? I would like to buy some fruit. Some oranges. Oranges? Alrighty, just a sec. The fruit vendor doesn't recognize me as the beast either. Any other year and they'd be a lot plumper than this. But this year, we've had the end of the war and this whole mess with the beast, and it's just been crazy. If you'd like, how about you come back in a few years and try your oranges again? They'll be several times better, I assure you. I'll keep that in mind. You bet, that'll be... I'm sorry, I don't have any local currency. Would this suffice? What? How is... No good, I take it? No, on the contrary. It's hardly fair for you trading a jewel for a few oranges. That's all I have to offer. I hope you can exchange it for money. Sure, you nobles or something else. Well, that ended... that went substantially better than I was expecting. He, like, actually managed to exchange currency for goods. Good job, Yukimasa. I'm proud of you. Noble, aren't you? Although if you wander around dressed too well, you put yourself in danger. You might find yourself stripped bare by a bandit, or perhaps even catch the attention of the beast. The beast. Everyone mentions the beast. They speak of me. Didn't, Javi, like, say that talking about the beast was taboo? It strikes me as inconsistent. Have you heard the tales? I have not. There's a beast's den not too far from this village. It's attacked before, and we've been living in fear, never knowing when it might attack again. But that all ends today. The men have finally found their spines. They all got together and went out to exterminate it. Ooh. Deeply questionable timing. Like, the first time he has left the house in literal months. And like, this is an excellent day to go try and murder him in his house. This will end well for us. What? And you'll never guess who's responsible. A kid! A little boy is spearheading the attack. Never would have expected a little kid to whip all our lazy, cowardly men into shape. The boy's the only one who knows where the beast's den... Ah, hold on. What about your oranges? Uh-oh. The men have banded together, and they're gonna kill the beast? Why now? Why when I'm not there? I'm the beast, I'm right here. I'm what you're trying to hunt. The only person at the mansion right now is her. See, I'm pretty sure white-haired girl has plot armor, so I'm less concerned than I would be otherwise. He regretted not asking the fruit vendor how long ago the party had set off. Though what good would that knowledge have done him? He had to hurry back regardless. The sun was beginning to set, draping the surroundings in a deep blackness. As if to keep him from returning home, the knight wrapped its hands around his head, covering both eyes. In what direction did he have to head to return to the mansion?
He stormed through the forest, and eventually, the mansion appeared before him, like the world fading into view after a dream. Bestia was a tempest in the night, blowing through the overgrowth toward the house. Please, please make it in time. I need her. I need the peace that she provides me. The last thing I want is for her to die. In the blink of an eye, he was through the door, charging down the mansion's halls. He could not sense anyone else inside, though. All he could hear was the whoosh of the wind blowing into the house from somewhere. It seemed a window was open. Or, you know, that, like, stained glass window you smashed. Where are you? Where have you gone? Answer me. Please answer me. Name! He cried out the girl's name again and again until his throat was sore and his voice hoarse. But she did not respond. He rushed into her bedchamber.
Yeah.
Hey, hello? Where are you? Answer me! The man swung his head back and forth so hard he thought he might break his own neck. And when he looked down, he slipped, falling on his tailbone. He felt something slick on his hands, a sensation he would recognize anywhere. The liquid was still warm. No, that cannot be. Wait, what? Why is there blood in here? That doesn't make any sense. It can't. It cannot be! Was she, like, throwing up blood? Like, that's the easiest explanation I can come up with. Or, like, the one that makes the most sense. Although that's pretty bad. Muttering incomprehensibly in fear, he crawled back through the door of her chamber and into the corridor. Like a genuine beast, he followed the trail of slippery fluid on all fours. The trail glimmered like red wine. It stretched down the hall, past the living room, smeared across the floor like it had been wiped down with a mop. The man crawled and crawled and crawled until at last he reached the stairs leading down to the cellar. The ruby trail continued. From beyond the door, he could hear men's voices.
Ah! Ah! Ah!
With a howl, the man stumbled down the stairs, throwing open the wooden door. Right, It makes sense that the search party would get here first, because they started off before Yuki did. His first impression was that the stench of blood was suffocating, and indeed, there he discovered the white-haired girl.
Ah! Ah!
He found himself unable to even scream. Wait, is she dead? Her once porcelain skin was no longer even sickly pale, it was now the bloodless color of dirt. She was sprawled haphazardly out on the cellar floor, dried blood stains around her half-open mouth. And those lips were, naturally, lacking their former rosy sheen. Her body was covered with an array of wounds, but the most prominent was the man's singular sword standing tall on her chest.
Huh!
I, like, just said she had plot armor. And now she has a sword in her chest. This is the Bestia? He doesn't look like the same. It's him. The same guy. He's the Bestia. Several villagers surrounded him at the behest of a young boy. He's gotten himself dressed all proper and fancy, but good clothes don't make him a good man. Isn't that right, you Bestia? No.
You murderer.
Why did you kill her? Why? You want to know why? Her death was an accident, I'd say. I feel bad about what happened. But any woman who would live with a man like you must be a witch. Does that hurt? Are you hurting right now, you Bestia? Then maybe now you understand. You not only stole my parents and friends from me, you ripped the last shard of hope I had from my hands. Do you get it? Do you finally understand how I feel? Now do you know how it feels to have someone you care about taken from you? Pauline was desperately trying to find you. Why? Why would you kill someone so devoted to you? Do you understand what you've done? I'm asking you a question, you goddamn murderer.
I see. And now, I have nothing left.
What? The man stepped forward, almost perfectly calm. His panic had vanished, as if it were never there. His eyes were disturbingly vacant. Perhaps the sorrow had overpowered him, beating his heart into quiet submission. No, that was not the case. Though his eyes were empty, a faint smile spread across his lips. The transition was swift, as though a gear had switched in his mind. The boy and the other villagers were frozen in place at the sight. Before long, the man was standing before the deceased girl's body. And then, he pulled the blade from her chest.
I knew it. I really was a beast. And what I wanted was a tether.
What are you yammering on about? Didn't you care about that woman? Didn't you choose her over Pauline? Who you then threw aside and butchered? What is wrong with you?
What was she to you?
She was my serenity. But she's dead now, and there's nothing I can do about that. Peace, calm, tranquility. Ah ha ha ha. The man's behavior was downright eerie, causing the boy to flinch back. Believing he'd had everything taken from him and could not possibly lose anything more was, I imagine, what had allowed him to stand up to the beast, the source of such crippling fear. Yet now, he found himself unable to move. He found himself, in the face of such an incomprehensible creature, paralyzed with fear. And the villagers were similarly dumbstruck. Not even I could understand his behavior. What the hell is wrong with you? How can you laugh at this? I don't get it! How? How indeed? I wonder myself. I don't know either. But you know what? It doesn't matter anymore. Because every last one of my anchors has broken off and sunken into the sea. Damn it, get moving, kill it. Ah, yes. I think he said just there, I'll slaughter each one, every last one of you. My whole life, I've always wanted to kill. Angry young man Yuki is. What was it that afflicted you with such madness? Losing your memory in the shipwreck? The abuse and insult you suffered at the villagers' hands? Or was it your grief at not being able to return to your homeland? No, none of those were the root. You were always like this. You always bore these twisted desires. You held these deep, constant urges to cause others harm. That is your essence. The real you, hidden beneath the mask of sincerity. The true beast was your heart. The beast was a convenient skin for you to wear. You wanted to be a brutal, savage murderer. You never really loved the white-haired girl, or the black-haired woman, for that matter. You were merely attached to them, fixated on the idea of a world of tranquility. You used this piece to anchor yourself, to prevent you from drifting off into the ocean of your desires. You yearned to cause pain, while also hungering for the opposite, a calm life. You idolized this idealized life, spent in quiet harmony with another, because you knew just how difficult it would be for you to attain. Far more difficult for you than satisfying your cravings, but not impossible. I, personally, had hoped you would find peace with someone rather than descend into savagery. It may have only been superficial, but it would have been very human. But ultimately, peace slipped through your fingers, and no one was left to suppress your desires. You cannot, after all, hold them back yourself. What a tragic man. What a hopeless man you are. I like how they don't even tell us how it ends. Like, does he kill the villagers? Do they kill him? I mean, I assume he wins. But it doesn't actually matter. What matters is, like, that entire sequence of events was fucked up. Alright, so, as promised, I got to the end of the second door, so that is where I will close the video for the evening. This was, what, like 2.5 hours or so? So, in the future, it looks like I might not be able to do 2 videos a door anymore. It might take me 3 for the next couple, but we will see, and I wish you all a pleasant time of day in location. Peace.